Welcome to the regularly scheduled Committee on Finance meeting for November 21st. Please silence your phones. Madam Clerk, item number one.
Mr. Chair, if we could have hats removed in the chamber as well?
Excuse me?
Hats removed from the chamber as well?
Please remove your hats. Thank you. Item number one.
Appointment, Mary Milligan as parking clerk for the City of Brockton, invited Mary Milligan.
Is Mary here tonight? Oh, there you are. Let me step forward. Questions, councilors?
Favorable recommendation back to full council.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you, Mary.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Item number two.
Appointment, Jamel Johnson as a special police officer for the City of Brockton for a one-year term ending November 2017. Invited Jamel Johnson.
I also see Lieutenant Mills here tonight. Thank you very much. Good evening, Mr. Johnson. Do you have anything you'd like to say?
I don't.
Any questions, councilors?
Mr. Chairman.
Council Farwell.
Just for the rest of my colleagues, this gentleman is going to become a school police officer. He's replacing one of two school police officers who have gone on to the Brockton PD, and that's the reason for the special police appointment request.
Thank you. Any other questions? Recommendation?
Move to recommend favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Good luck and stay safe, officer.
Thank you.
Item number three.
Reappointment, Daniel Campbell as a constable in the City of Brockton for a term of 3 years. Invited Daniel Campbell.
Good evening, Mr. Campbell.
Hi, Councilor.
Any questions? Councilor Sullivan.
Chairman, thank you. Good evening, Mr. Campbell. How are you tonight?
I'm doing good. And yourself?
Good, thanks. How long have you, this is a reappointment, how long have you been a constable in the city?
I want to say about 15 years.
15 years. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Recommendation?
Make a motion for favorable recommendation.
Second.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you, Mr. Campbell, and good luck.
Council.
Item number four.
Order that the sum of $2 million is appropriated to pay costs of inspecting and rehabilitating 7 miles of the parallel 24-inch transmission mains from the Silver Lake Water Treatment Plant to the Browns Crossing Pump Station, including the payment of all costs incidental and related thereto, and that to meet this appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, is authorized to borrow said amount under the pursuant to the Chapter 44 and or Chapter 29C of the general laws, or pursuant to any other enabling authority, and to issue bonds or notes of the city, therefore, that such bonds or notes shall be general obligations of the city unless the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, determines that they should be issued as limited obligations and may be secured by local system revenues as defined in section portion of such amount from the Massachusetts Clean Water Trust, the trust. Established pursuant to Chapter 29C and in connection therewith to enter into a financing agreement and or security agreement with the trust and otherwise to contract with the trust and the Department of Environmental Protection with respect to such loan and for any federal or state available for the project or for the financing thereof, and that the mayor is authorized to enter into a project regulatory agreement with the Department of Environmental Protection to expend all funds available for the project and to take any other action necessary to carry out the project. Further ordered, any premium received by the city upon the sale of any bonds or notes approved by this order, lest any such premium applied to the payment of the cost of issuance of such bonds or notes may be applied to the payment of costs approved by this order in accordance with Chapter 44, Section 20 of the general laws, thereby reducing the amount authorized to be borrowed to pay such costs by a like amount. Further ordered that the city treasurer is authorized to file an application with the Commonwealth of Massachusetts Municipal Finance Oversight Board to qualify under Chapter 44A of the general laws, and any and all bonds or notes of the city authorized by this vote, and to provide such information and execute such documents as the Municipal Finance Oversight Board of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts may require. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Martin Brophy, Treasurer Tax Collector, Larry Rowley, DPW Commissioner, Brian Creedon, Water System Manager, David Norton, DPW Water Sewer Contract Administrator, Ozzie Jordan, Water Commissioning Board, and Kate Archard, Water Commission.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Rowley.
Good evening, Councilor. Councilors, this has been an ongoing project since May 27th of 2015, and I don't think any of us here want to relive that moment again with the transmission the way it ruptured. and we couldn't get water to Brockton. So what we've come up with the help of our CDM Smith, as our engineers, is there were 7 crossover gates. And what I mean by crossover is we can switch the water from one main to the other, so in case whatever is ruptured, we can work on that one and still get water to Brockton. So what we found out about those 7 crossovers is none of them are working. We've gone down there, we've excavated around them, and we tried to get them to work one way or the other. So that's why we're looking for this money to repair this. And also this money will cover to do an assessment of the structure of the inside of the pipe also, which they it's called a smart ball. They throw the smart ball through the main, and that does an assessment, especially a leak detection assessment of the inside of the main, and it does a lot of other things. So we'll get a good idea of how that pipe is, but right now this money is strictly going to valves. So we can do this assessment work, and we can, there are 7 of them, we're gonna replace 3 of them, and the other 4 we're gonna remove. So any questions?
Councilor Barnes.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioner, just something you just said, and I just want to be clear. So if 7 of the pipes that we have are broken, and if I understood you correctly, you said that you'd send kind of like a scope or something through that, does that damage the pipe anymore, or?
No, Council. Okay. And what maybe I didn't make it clear. These are crossover valves that we can switch water from one main to the other. In case one main ruptures, we can still keep water coming to Brockton.
Divert it to another.
Which we couldn't do the last leak we had, because that's why we had to shut down Silver Lake, and that's why we almost ran out of water here in the city. So this will prevent this from happening again.
Okay.
And I just like to state that the stretch of pipe that we worked on, there were no crossover valves in that area, so we got criticized for a lot for not finding them, and that's why we had to shut the water down. There were none in that stretch.
Okay.
But in that 7-mile stretch, there are 7 crossovers, and we have to have them repaired. We're gonna repair 3 of them, and the other 4, we're just gonna leave in place. Because they are on, I shouldn't say that, we're gonna have to do an insertion valve, which means we can do it with the pressure going through the pipes. There's a technique that you can do that. So there will be no disruption to the residents of Brockton while we're doing that. Might be a little dirty water or whatever. We'll send out statements when we're gonna do all this work.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Commissioner. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Farwell.
I'd like to just ask Mr. Condon a question, if I could.
Councilor.
I noticed that you had a very tightly worded conditional certification on this particular borrowing, and you and I spoke a little bit about it, and I want to make sure that, and I don't really have any opposition to this, but I want to make sure we're not backing ourselves into a situation where we're going to have a dramatic increase in water rates, because in I might add, you've also in past budgets mentioned that we are millions of dollars behind what we should be. So could you just expound a little bit on what you see the implications to be if this is approved and the borrowing is authorized?
Yes. So a couple of years ago, the Water Commission came in and made a request for a 30% rate increase. There had been about 6 years where the city's rates hadn't been increased for water. What the council did was it delayed that increase by 6 months. Instead of July 1st, it ended up being effective on January 1st. And it broke it up into 3 pieces of 10% each. So last year, fiscal 16, that just ended on June 30, would have been the first year we would have received any benefit from that rate increase for 6 months, you know, from January 1st to the end of the fiscal year. We estimated a budget where we'd receive that would have been like a 5% on a, you know, 10% on a half-year basis is 5%, but we didn't fully realize that last year. So even last year, the revenues were not what we'd hoped they would have been. We were a little bit under $15 million. So we're a little bit in the hole on the basis of that. Then the fact that the 30% was having been stated by the Water Commission, which I supported, was really needed at that point because of the delay in receiving a rate increase for that period of time, and the fact that the city's general fund was now carrying cost for the Water Enterprise Fund, which weren't being reimbursed. That condition continues. So what I've said is that you've got a budget which isn't really adequate with the revenues at the moment. At the time that that rate increase was passed, there had been a number of cuts that had been made to the water budget, which really ought to have been restored if we had the adequate revenues, especially with respect to capital and with respect, they used to have a crew in the water division that's entire responsibility was going around and replacing these old 2-inch mains throughout the city and doing leak detection. That crew was eliminated because of budget cuts. So I think we need a stronger system of rates. We're going to get there over time because of that action the City Council took, but we're lagging where we need to be. So my conditional certification says this adds to the problem, not a great amount of money, because $2 million would be borrowed, paid over 20 years. It wouldn't be an awful lot of money, but it's being layered on top of what's already an adequate revenue structure, and it will take us a while to catch up from that. So that's basically what my conditional certification is talking about. I can't say you're not going to have a zero impact with it, because it's already a budget which is too tight for the best interest of the city, especially with respect to capital spending.
All right, if we approve this and we go out to borrow and we don't have a rate increase at least in the near future or before the next bond rating review, do we risk taking a hit?
On the bond rating, I think the fact that the rates aren't adequate now, we're in a negative outlook at the moment because of the city's revenue posture. So I wouldn't be surprised if that is either exacerbated. I don't think this alone would result in a downgrade, but we're at a risk to some extent for that. But certainly we wouldn't get our negative outlook removed because they think the bond rating agencies think one of the things the city should be doing is taking more aggressive action with respect to its revenue base. I've made a recommendation. I don't know that the council will adopt it, would take an ordinance change to do it, to try to insert one 10% increase in the middle of this series of 10. That would help a great deal. If it doesn't happen, I still think you should borrow the money for this project, because this particular project's impact, it's not going to be the straw that breaks the camel's back. It just exacerbates what's already an unhealthy situation. Now, we have applied for grants on this project. If we're successful, I think we're on a pre-approval list. If we're successful, some portion of this impact would be mitigated. Most likely we would get a grant which gives us an interest rate subsidy, so we'd only be paying 2%. If we get more than that, we would be applying, as this order says, it's a long convoluted order as you heard it as it was read, we'd applying those proceeds to reduce the amount of money that we had to borrow. But I don't think it's very likely we'll get 100% assistance on this.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Mr. Connor. How are you?
Good.
I just had a couple questions on this, Jay. Relative to the actual loan order language, the verbiage itself states, such bonds or notes shall be general obligations of the city unless the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, determines that they should be issued as limited obligations and may be secured by local systems revenues as defined. And I guess why I bring that up is, what are the chances that indeed would become a limited as opposed to a general?
That's generic language that comes from bond council. Some of it is important. That particular language is generic in case we decided to issue revenue bonds. I don't think we'd be able to with the present position of the water revenue fund. Most likely it would be a general obligation bond of the city, and we may at the end borrow it from this trust fund as opposed to a general obligation issue, but it would still be the taxpayer's responsibility. We'd get a better interest rate by doing that.
And what do you think the 20 years, if you amortize this over 20 years, it's not going to be a lot in terms of the whole budget, but you said if we get the grant, the interest could be about 2%. But what do you think, what's a municipal bond interest as of like today?
Well, in these days, that grant helps, but it's not great because rates are so low. Yeah, I mean, you know, we could probably borrow on a general obligation bond for 20 years at 3.5% or 4%. So,
okay. Thank you, Mr. Connor. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Razak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Mr. Connor.
Good evening, Councilor.
You just stated that we applied for a grant. When do we find out about the grant?
I think there's a preliminary list that's expected to be issued in December. And then the final awards are probably made in January. We apply across the state, and there are other projects, which, although I think we'll do well on this one because of the nature of the project itself, it's a pretty critical project with the size of the city and the fact that until we do that work, we're at risk for losing our capacity to take water from Silver Lake.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Ranieri.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Mr. Connor. How are you?
Good.
Just to follow up a little bit on what Councilor Fowler was talking about a few moments ago, and I just want to make sure that I have it clear in my mind, and hopefully everybody that's listening at home and here has it also clear, that by us voting to to accept this evening and moving this forward does not indicate or necessitate in any way that we're raising the water rates here at the same time.
Does not.
Because that would take an ordinance change to do that, correct?
It does not. It would take an ordinance action by the City Council, and notwithstanding what the certification letter that I've provided says, the City Council is obliged to take no action with respect to that letter.
Right, and listening to what you indicated, I understand what you were saying, you know, the A's and the No's about it, but I mean, we have to do this, I think, this evening, because if not, we're going to be in a tough position,
yes,
as the DPW Commission has told us. Again, and that's going to be even a worse situation if we had that situation happen to people without water 7, 8, 10, 12 days.
No, that's correct.
Seriously.
You know, okay. I mean, you've been around a while, Counselor. And you know that Chapter 324 of Act 1990 puts a specific obligation on me to provide an opinion.
Right.
It doesn't oblige the City Council to take an action it doesn't think is in this best
interest. Exactly, and that's why sometimes it's nicer to hear a little bit more in a layman's language, and the way I know you have to, you know, derive at it, and it's being the certification part of it. But I just want to make sure that piece is not what we're working on tonight. It's just getting this done, and let's get moving forward with it.
That's
because
right.
It's and a need-based situation for the city in the best interest of the people here.
Exactly true. I really think you need to do this, as everybody seems to believe, and that with respect to the rates, that's up to the City Council to take action or not take action at some future date.
Exactly. Understood. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Counselor.
Just one quick one.
Counselor Monahan.
Yes, Mr. Riley. Just a quick one. If we pass this, when will you start this?
Well, there's still a lot of planning that has to go into this. It's a, you know, it's a very sensitive project, especially where we're going to be excavating close to these old mains. But it is going now, so that's why we're looking for this appropriation, and then we'll get it going even quicker. So I'm hoping sometime in the spring we can start this work.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you. Entertain a motion.
Move for a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full City Council. All those in favor? All those opposed, recommend favorably.
Thank you, Councilor.
Mr. Thank Chairman.
You. Item number five.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Farwell.
We have a number of people here on item 24. I'd like to move to take that out of order.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to take item 24 out of order. All those in favor? All those opposed? Madam Clerk, please read item number 24.
Resolved to invite Fire Chief to appear before a committee of this Council to review expenditure for Granite from the Fire Department budget, and to bring with him any and all documents related to such expenditure, included any supporting contract. Invited Michael Williams, Fire Chief.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Ianeri.
Mr. Chairman, if I might, I just want to just speak briefly in regards to this particular item. I believe it's an item that's coming out of the Accounts Committee, and this particular item was discussed at the Accounts Committee meeting just a few weeks ago. And I believe, you know, at that point in time, the Accounts Committee wanted to make a motion, which they did, and act on it, that this item be brought before the Council for discussion. And I just want it understood, because it did end up becoming a media item, and when it got into the media, it sort of took and grew some other legs than what we probably anticipated. But I want people to understand that in no such way was the Accounts Committee doing anything to point a finger at anyone, accuse anyone of anything. I think when we were looking over our own records in regards to payments that are made within the city and coming from the appropriated money that we as a council put forth to make sure the city runs correctly, you know, we found that there was a situation that we wanted to have some more questions to, and we felt the best way to do it would be to have it sent to the full City Council and invite the chief in to discuss it. Unfortunately, in some sense of the way, some other councilors also stepped in the middle and muddied the water a little bit, but I guess they have a right to do so at some point. But, you know, I, as chairman of the committee, I was not too pleased with that when five members voted to send it back here and get the straight answers from the chief. And in the interim, I spoke with the chief on several occasions, and so did a couple other members of the subcommittee. I just clearly want it understood. The job of the Accounts Committee is to do as such. And that's just what we've been doing in this last past year. It wasn't done in the correct way under my presidency last year, nor was it done correctly under the presidency of Councilor Sullivan. But, Mr. Chairman, it is being done correctly under yours. You appointed us to do the job, and that's what we're doing. And when we were going through the bills and found something that just was there was a roadblock, we needed to have it discussed. So that's why it's here. Again, not pointing fingers at anybody, accusing anybody of any wrongdoing. We're just trying to make it an easy resolution, and I think we've met that. So that being said, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I know the chief is here to answer questions.
Thank you. Good evening, Chief.
Good evening, Counselor.
Do we have questions, or do we... Counselor Farwell.
I don't really have a question. I guess I've got a statement that you fell into this simply because your name happens to be on the purchase order that was paid. From what I've been able to find out, and I probably have spent more time in this than most issues, you had been a chief 3 weeks. We had a $4.8 million City Hall Plaza reconstruction project. Built into that, I might add, was a 12% contingency. $498,000 was set aside for cost overruns or change orders. I don't know how you got that purchase order to pay out of what was supposed to be the operating budget for the fire department, but I think that's how you got roped into it. Mm-hmm. And echoing what Councilor Iannarri said, we look for things that we think we need to bring to the council to protect the interests of the taxpayer. We never thought that someone had stolen $8,000 worth of granite, because that's not easy to make off with, and I know you're going to bring us up to speed in a minute on what happened to it. But I will also say to everyone here, it's a good thing this happened, and I say that because we've got to have a process in place where we do major construction projects, and we have materials received, and then we have materials used, and then we have surplus materials. And we need a storage area for those, and we need to account for those. In the age of computers with a Microsoft Excel spreadsheet, that's not too tough to do. So if nothing else has come out of this, given the fact that we're going to do a $10 million parking garage and we're going to undertake other major projects downtown, it's kind of a wake-up call that, you know, let's get our act together, let's have the different processes in place to make sure this doesn't happen again. When this was first raised on October 17th, an email probably could have satisfied a lot of the questions. But you know what? It fell through the cracks. And human beings, I didn't send one out, and other people didn't. And that might have tweaked your interest, and you would have told us what happened to the granite. But I think a positive has come out of this, if nothing else, in that we're more aware of what our obligations are to protect the interests of the residents. So I thank you for being here, even though you're kind of an unwitting participant in all of this.
Right. Well, Councilor, let me just begin by saying that my participation in this entire process was very limited, in that there was an issue, and I don't know how deep you want to get into the prior issue before it came to my involvement, but there was some issues with the construction company doing City Hall Plaza and the Firefighters Local Union and the Strand Theater Committee. There was a discrepancy in the granite that was delivered for the project. The construction company had the thought that the granite was close enough to what was ordered originally. The firefighters were not in agreement. There was a difference of opinion on whether the construction company should buy new granite or whether the firefighters should just accept the granite that was delivered, even though it was not the correct granite, we believe. It was basically a standoff, and I think Mayor Carpenter looked at it as he really didn't want to see this project take a turn for the worst, and looked for some avenues to rectify the problem. Between Chief Financial Officer Condon, the mayor, and myself, my budget was looked at, and there is a line item in my budget for buildings, grounds, and maintenance. We felt that this was closely related to that, and that because it was such a unique situation, that we would spend the money out of that account to correct the problem, not to hold up the project anymore. There may have been another confusing issue here. There was two purchase orders. So I'm not sure whether some people may have been confused whether the granite was purchased twice. That's not the case. One of the purchase orders was for the new granite. The other purchase order was for the labor to have the incorrect granite removed and replaced with the correct granite. That's the reason for the two purchase orders. Two different companies. One company supplied the granite, another company did the actual removal and installation of the new granite.
Well, just in conclusion, I would say again, I think there were multiple innocent failures along the way. I also think you and most people know that if there were any evidence that something unlawful had been done, you know, having been a product of 7 Commercial Street, I'd be calling the appropriate person. I think people operated in good faith, but we can't let $8,000 or any city property go to a private location anymore. I mean, this is 2016, and the city has to get up to speed with the way you handle these issues. And I thank you for the time you put into it. And with that, I yield back to you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilors? Councilor Burns.
Thank you. Chief, I just have one question. So you mentioned that there were two purchase orders that may be people may think that they went for the same thing or that they were the same actual order, but they're two different things. What were they? You said one was for the actual purchase and the other was for the labor. Okay, so were they the same amount? Is that?
No, I don't know. Councilors, I have them with me. I don't know if you need, I could send you copies of these.
Yes, please.
They're within $1,000 of each other. One is $8,250. Now that's the actual cost for the granite itself. The second purchase order is for $9,078. That was for a different company to supply the labor.
All right.
For the removal and installation.
Okay, and where is it now? Where is this granite in question now, right now?
It's at the DPW yard.
In the yard, okay.
Mm-hmm.
So how long had it been in this private location till it was moved to DPW?
I believe this all took place July, August of 2015, so it's been a little over a year.
Okay. And are you in any way able to determine if the same amount that was deposited originally was the same as it was transferred, weight and all of that stuff?
I was told it was one piece. One piece was broken when they removed it. So I believe that the number is about 50. The original number was 51 pieces, and I believe now there's 50.
51 to 50, you said?
Right.
Okay. All right. And yes, if you could just submit those invoices, that would be great.
Sure.
Appreciate that. Thank you, Chief. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilors?
Just one.
Councilor Ranieri.
Just one comment. And Chief, knowing that is located back at with the DPW area, if I'm not mistaken, correct? I mean, it's there and it's to remain there at such point or whatever the desire is of the city in itself to utilize. I don't think it can in any such way be donated to anything. I don't believe. I think if anyone would be donating, then that would be the mayor to make that decision. He'd have to come back before the city council to ask for us to release that appropriated funds for that, you know, for that situation, the amount of money that it costs for those bricks. So
just quickly again, Councilor, I have no responsibility for
correct.
That granite.
Correct. No one's saying that.
Yep.
Definitely, Chief. No.
Okay.
I just want to make sure it's clear that we know where it is, and if anything is to be done with that person's got to come back before this body to do it. So, no. I appreciate everything and everything you've done to help us square it away. So, with that being said, I move that it goes back to the City Council with a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Mr. Chairman, on the motion.
On the motion.
If no one objects, I just had a quick question for Mr. Condon. Anybody
object? There's no objections.
Thank you, Chief. Mr. Conan, in terms of this stone, you know, granite company doing work with the municipality and the Commonwealth, typically there's a punch list, and if the firefighters think that it's not the right color and the city agrees with that, usually there's I'm surprised that they stood fast and said, yeah, go pound sand. Has this company supplied stone to the city of Brockton? Usually there's a mechanism for either arbitration or they just say, you know, if it costs doing business here, we want to make you happy. And that's what confuses me, that a business would play hardball with the firefighters vis-a-vis the city. Quite honestly, it's the city.
Right.
So have we ever done any work or have we done any work since that time with them?
I don't know the answer to that question, Counselor. I wasn't really involved in the dispute itself, except when the mayor said that we'd like to use this appropriation. I said, there's a connection to the fire department. I think would be okay. The law department, I think, was involved in those negotiations with that company. So I don't know whether the company has ever been used before. I doubt we'd use it again based on this experience. It may have been because the bulk of the money was through the state. It may have been that we were required. I don't know that for sure. We're required to use the company. It may have been a state contractor. And the company that provided the granite in the second instance, the granite that's out there now, is a different company.
Right, I was talking about that original one.
Yes.
If we could, and it's a little bit off track, but if we could maybe find if they were on the state mandate list, I'd like to know that if we could. Thank you.
We'll run that down.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably, full city council. Madam Clerk, item number 5.
Order appropriation of $25,000 from the unappropriated estimated receipts of the general fund for fiscal year 2017 to the law department ordinary maintenance services. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Philip Nazarella, City Solicitor.
Mr. Nazarella.
Good evening.
Good evening.
If I may, members of the council, this appropriation is simply for the to invest in a third-party administrator for our workman's compensation claims and injured on duty claims. We believe that this entity, Cooking Company, which has a vast amount of experience in municipalities, has been quite successful in assisting municipalities in handling injured on duty claims. They participate in the payment of medicals, negotiating fees with the doctors. We've been relatively successful in those aspects. They have a certain degree of success with doctors and physicians they know. The primary purpose of this appropriation in engaging Cook and Company is to more closely monitor the medical care given to the municipal employees, particularly those in the public safety sector, to see that they are getting the appropriate care and that they are able to leave an injured on duty status to back to work. And that in itself will result in significant savings to the city. So we believe that this will be an appropriate measure, and we think it will certainly be a positive factor for the city.
Councilor Monahan.
Yes, good evening, Mr. Neville. So are we already doing this on our own?
We're doing it on our own. In fact, Mary Milligan is the one that's been doing it for the last several years. And we found that the one-person operation has been presently inundated with so much work because claims for injured on duty have grown disproportionately. I mean, it's just out of sight. The paperwork and oversight of her office or her has been very taxing. We believe that by bringing this particular entity in that has very positive reviews from every other municipality it's worked in will result in our expeditious services to the city and to the employee. And again, they'll have proper managed care. We'll be able to communicate with utilization review components of a person's care. And the end result will be to get that injured on duty individual back to work sooner than the norm has been.
Does this company decide if the person is eligible for workman's comp or as they go along through the process? What exactly is the job? I mean, you said she's been inundated with work here, but I don't know if this is a benefit to the employees.
The benefit of the employees will be they'll have a closer managed care by the intervention of this third-party administrator dealing with the physicians, dealing with the care staff, whether it be the nursing staff, and dealing with the utilization review committees who monitor and make determinations on an employee status. We found now that the curve line on injured on duty is rather extensive. It's a long period of time, and we do not have the capacity to intervene and check the status on a day-by-day, week-by-week basis, because there are so many components to that type of operation between nursing staff, patient care attendants, physicians attendants, or assistants. This company is very adept at doing that, and we feel that, again, my goal is to accomplish two critical aspects. One, to manage the care of the injured employee in a proper manner, and to monitor the status so that injured employee can get back to work. Because we are spending currently more than I think historically we've ever spent in the injured on duty claims, and we feel that with this $25,000 investment, it'll pay for itself in the very short run. Plus, it also give guidance to the law department on the implementation of certain rules, regulations, and laws that they work with each day. So it's going to cover many aspects, not only as consulting to us, but consulting to the person at the workman's compensation in injured on duty claims.
Okay, I've had myself bad experience with third parties, especially where I'm working.
Well, now, if I may interrupt, Counselor. We intend, we're not just going to hand over the files and walk away. They're going to be linked in with us. We're going to be monitoring them. And one of the assistant attorneys' function will be to work exclusively or primarily with this particular company to ensure that we are getting the most we can from each dollar we're spending with them and seeing that they're living up to the claims that they represented to us, which they intend to accomplish. So they're not going to be going unchecked. We're not turning our eyes off of what their function is. We will be working, and they're not doing it exclusively either. We'll still be maintaining our functions, but they will be coming in to assist and hopefully expedite some of the services that we wish to afford the municipal employees.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Ranieri.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Attorney Nazarello.
Good evening.
How are you?
Thank you.
I do want to just make one quick comment, because I know Mary Milligan's been doing the job for a good many years, and she's done an outstanding job with it as well. I one day walked into her office just to say hello to her, and when I ever saw the books and materials that stood in front of her, I was like Everett Oz to even how she even kept track of everything that was going on, but she was able to. Cook & Company, I believe, has been around for a long time.
Yes, it's very well known in the area, very experienced, and I think they're the primary third-party administrators.
Exactly, and just coming up on the heels of Council Monahan, I mean, yes, we all get concerned when there's a third party coming in, but I mean, you did indicate that we're going to be there, we're going to be watching every step of the
Absolutely.
Way as well.
Absolutely, we're not abdicating power, control, and oversight. They're working for us. They're not just walking off with it.
Yeah, I know when I worked for the Sheriff's Department, and it was some years ago, but Cook & Company came in and became our third party with all and everything that was transpiring, at the Plymouth County Sheriff's Department, the jail in itself. I mean, with all kinds of different situations and everybody out on workers' comp. We had to bring in a third party, and that's the company we had selected. And I think it was under Sheriff Flynn at that time. So, I mean, I speak highly of it. I think at this point, $25,000, I think, is short money, but I think it's something that has to be monitored, and I think it works in the best interest of all of us and those that are. Maybe we can get some people back to work a little bit faster, too.
Well, that's the goal. And to further your comment, anyone who walks in Mary Milligan's office or that particular office will see it inundated with files, paperwork, and a constant flow of employees coming in. Now, all due respect to Mary Milligan, the only thing she hasn't been able to accomplish is guarantee immortality or that she won't get sick on a given day. That's disastrous when she's right. not present. And to Absolutely. Have a one-person operation in a city like this really isn't business-wise.
There's too much at risk. I agree with you. So, I support it, so I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First, my apologies for my voice is all with this nasty cold that I have. But I have a quick question for you, Mr. Nazarella. Let me just make a statement first, and then I'll tell you what I'm thinking of. I'm not against this funding, but I do have a problem with the fact that you're here in front of us asking for this fund. Your budget last year was $2.4 million. This year, in FY17, we're looking at $4.1 million. So you're telling me that you couldn't come up somewhere from within your budget, You've got $350,000 in outside counsel in consulting.
Mm-hmm.
So you couldn't take the $25,000 out of that line item to provide this needed services, but yet you're coming in front of us here asking us to provide additional funding to you. Why couldn't you just take that out of the money?
Much of that budget is reserved for anticipated litigation, which again is on the rise that we have no control over. Tort claims, settlement claims. It's going to be a long year. We already have a lot in the pipeline right now. And all I would be doing is juggling from one hand to the other, but I'd still be coming back before you. This, again, is a very minimal amount in relation to the expenses that are generated and the claims that are pending over us. Right now, we have numerous files in litigation, federal court, superior court, land court. We anticipate, to some degree, there will be some settlement claims. There may be judgments against the city. So that's all on reserve, and that's been analyzed and prejudged well in advance by both myself and outside counsel that those are the appropriate amounts to hold in reserve.
Well, again, I'm not against the monies that you're looking for and the needs for it. All I'm saying is that in a department whose budget doubled, almost doubled from one year to the other, why could you not find the $25,000 elsewhere to put into this particular program?
Well, as I just stated, Counselor, because not only has the budget's doubled for a certain reason, it's because the claims have doubled, the judgments have increased, and we anticipate there's going to be substantial cost for both outside counsel, for litigation, and settlement and judgments.
I understand all of that, but what I'm saying to you is that you're here in front of us asking us for this money. My advice to you, why wouldn't you not take it from someplace else, and when you cross that bridge where you need additional funding, then come back and ask for additional monies? Because right now you do have the funds, you do have it in your budget. Why wouldn't you just not take $25,000 out of that and pay for this?
Because we processed it based on another view of this, that we already know for injured on duty claims or what have you, there are going to be certain reserves that we're going to be using those funds. So this was a determination, the process made both within my office and in consultation with Mr. Condon. We think it's the most appropriate way to go.
Well, I just want to let you know that, again, I'm not against the idea, but I'm going to vote against it because I think you could do a better job finding this money within your budget to do that.
Well, the money is within the budget. I don't have to find it. It's there. It's how I'm going to expend it. I already know I may have to expend that money. So it's not a question of me not being able to find the funds. I know it's there, but we already have calculated case by case that's in the office what we're going to have to spend, both in defense, litigation, settlement, or judgments. And that's all been accounted for.
No, but you're asking for the $25,000 from the general funds.
Correct.
To go towards you. So that's what I'm saying to you.
No, I understand your position.
You know, but I'm basically letting you know that I'm not going to support this because I think you can find the money someplace else. And whenever you need additional funds, then you come back and you ask us for it. You know, but this whole idea of, you know, we're just going to come to the council and ask for whatever we want to ask for in hopes that we get it, it's just, it has to stop sometimes. I mean, we just spent a great deal of time talking about an $8,000 piece of granite, you know, but yet we're just willy-nilly appropriating $25,000 because you just come
well,
to
I would
and
take,
saying that it is.
I would take different with you on the word willy-nilly. It's not a willy-nilly process. And these monies, we're not talking about granite. They're going to pay claims on individuals, litigants, employees. So there was a long process and as exact calculation as we could make it. I understand your position. I can see what you're saying.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Motion? Move for a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Councilors, before we get to the rest of these appropriations, since we took item 24 out of order because we had a crowd, I'd like to entertain a motion to take item number 23, and then we'll do 26. Excuse me. Yeah, I believe 23. Hold on a minute.
So moved.
Second. Yeah, 23. Motion made and seconded to take item 23 out of order. All those in favor? All those opposed? Madam Clerk, please read item 23.
Resolved to invite Jesse Pack, coordinator of the COPE Center, to discuss the policies and practices of the clean syringe distribution, a background on the history of other services you provide, the safeguards in place with the programs, and the plans for future programs regarding substance abuse. Invited Jesse Pack, coordinator of the COPE Center, Anthony Simonelli Bamsey.
Good evening, Mr. Simonelli. Councilor Beauregard, I believe this is your resolve.
Good evening.
Thank you, Mr.
Good evening.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Mr. Simonelli. I had asked, invited Jesse Pack, and Mr. Simonelli had mentioned that he would speak on behalf of the COPE Center, which is located on Pleasant Street here in downtown Brockton. And we'd go over the process because we've had a lot of problems with syringes, finding them in our neighborhoods, at our playgrounds, our schools, and houses of worship. And, you know, it doesn't have to look far. On the latest, what was this, Thursday, October 27th, in our local paper discussing the needle exchange program. So maybe I'll have Mr. Simonelli elaborate first, and then we'll go into questions, and I want to open this up to my colleagues also. Thank you.
Good evening, Mr. Simonelli.
Good evening.
Give us a brief background on the COPE Center.
I'd be happy to. The COPE Center, which stands for Community Outreach Prevention and Education, has been located in its current location on Pleasant Street for over two decades. It initially was started because that area of town 20 years ago, and to some degree still today, was designated as an area where there was a high-risk population that was certainly seen by the Department of Public Health. Our program is not simply a needle exchange program. Our program, COPE, is a harm reduction program for individuals with high risk. And that harm reduction includes HIV testing, testing for hepatitis C, hepatitis A and B vaccinations, testing for sexually transmitted diseases. Our staff distribute condoms, and our goal overall has been to keep infection from spreading and getting increasingly high over the course of the city by dealing with a population that very rarely seeks out medical care. We have an LPN on staff. She takes care of a lot of the injections that people get for immunizations, and at the same time she takes care of a lot of minor problems like frostbite and so forth. It's also a drop-in center where people, rather than being on the street, can go and be in a place where they have staff, they can interact with those individuals, and our goal is to provide health education to these individuals. This is not simply a needle exchange program. Needle exchange, we were requested through an RFP by the Department of Public Health to add this to our repertoire of services in May. I can say in no uncertain terms that syringes on the street of Brockton is something that we don't want to see. And the root of that problem is not our needle exchange program. We've simply only been doing it since May. The root of the problem is addiction. And it is not just the Brockton problem. This is a problem that hampers many, many cities, municipalities across the Commonwealth. In fact, there will be needle exchange programs opening up in Fall River and Taunton. There are already needle exchange programs in Boston and many communities out west. The goal of our program is to reduce infection. In addition to distributing clean needles, we collect clean needles. It is now a one-to-one exchange. So someone who has a needle has to bring in a dirty needle to get a clean needle. That's just exactly the way the program works. At this particular moment in time, what has been given to our organization is we have individuals who walk the streets of Brockton and on a weekly basis hand pick up needles off the street. And I can tell you that the individuals that BMC sends out on the street pick up an average of 500 needles a week. I can also tell you that we have virtually gotten back as many needles as we have distributed since May. In addition to that, we have oftentimes we talk to individuals to get them to seek services. Since May, we had 32 individuals agree to seek service in terms of drug rehab, because that really is the root of the problem. Now, 32 out of 300 is not a great number, but it is still 32 people in a beginning program that are willing to access drug rehabilitation. In addition to that, with our HIV testing, we've had over 300 people register for this program. We've tested almost 150 people for HIV, and we've uncovered 3 cases of HIV, which is extremely dangerous for people in this community. And at least those 3 people that we have tested and had positive results are not in the streets and taking proper precaution and treatment. So that is essentially what we're doing. I don't want anyone to think that this is just a needle exchange program that just opened up in Brockton. This is a harm reduction program for high-risk individuals that we've been doing for over 20 years. So I'd be happy to take questions.
Councilor Borger.
Okay, again, I'll indulge my colleagues. I have a little list here. So we've cleared up that when an individual comes in for a syringe, they return one. So it's a one for one. Now, if so, does someone at BMC inspect the used needles and verify that the individuals are actually returning a whole used syringe as opposed to just pieces of a syringe, or did they find this in the trash or something like that?
We don't inspect the needles. If an individual comes in with a needle, we put it carefully away in a shop's container. The other thing that we do is when individuals are given needles, we give them a small container to put those needles in so that they don't throw them on the streets.
Now, do they return those containers to you?
Well, I can't tell you exactly how many containers that have been returned, but we do get containers returned, but not all of the time. I think you have to look at the fact that people that are addicted to injectable drugs are their behavior often is not consistent, and we can't they're not necessarily the most organized individuals in the world, and so consequently, there's no way to keep track of that.
Now, so right now, does BMC keep track of what they distribute? Is there a label or a mark that indicates you that BMC gave them out from the COPE Center versus that they robbed, someone of their syringes or?
We keep track of the syringes that go out and the syringes that come back.
But right now there's no marking that indicates that the syringes came from the COPE Center versus another.
I think that would be impossible to do.
Because I'm
and not- I think that certainly, I think the Commonwealth of Massachusetts has set up a protocol for this. So this isn't a BMZ protocol that we've just made up.
Oh, no, I realize.
So there's a protocol in the state for doing this, and we're following the protocol that the state has issued to us. So there is no indication where there is marking, inspection of markings, because you have to understand that handling dirty syringes is a very dangerous business. And inspecting those and looking at them rather than to just properly secure them in a container would be counterproductive and would be putting our own people at risk. In addition to that, we have also, anytime there's a request either by police, fire, or anyone, or any place in town or any high-risk area in town, we're happy to provide shops containers as well so those needles could be properly discarded.
Okay, I'm familiar with these containers, and I guess that is one of, and I realize that the individuals that you pass on that have addiction situations are not likely to be, as you mentioned, organized and have the follow through. So, you mentioned that you send people out weekly to collect the syringes in this community.
No, I actually didn't say that. I said that at the end of every week, They go out on multiple days, and at the end of every week, we collect about 500 needles a week off the streets that people pick up and collect.
Okay, thank you. Now, you know, so you answered about the trading, and you mentioned that the LPN helps them with medical services, because this was one of our concerns. The location of COPE, to me, it seems it would be better served for everyone involved if it was closer to a medical facility that, you know, maybe offers an emergency room and other treatment, because, you know, you highlighted, for example, the frostbite, but there are other concerns, certainly nutritional concerns, et cetera, and other diseases that come of, how would I say it, not proper nutrition or health care. And you mentioned that most of them do not seek medical attention, and that is a concern. And like I said, you know, we've been finding them in playgrounds and parks. So I'm happy to hear that you send multiple individuals out looking for them. Do you get their ages when the individuals come in?
Well,
to
let
trade
me
these
let
syringes?
Me just before we go on to ages, let me just address this particular question.
Sure.
We have been in this location for over 2 decades.
I realize that. Yes.
Okay. We have been providing the same type of services now as we have done then. We have had actually a medical facility move across the street. The Brockton Neighborhood Health Center has a satellite across
the
street.
Yes.
Okay. We are already affiliated with the Brockton Neighborhood Health Center. We've had a supermarket move in. So it isn't that these businesses located there and then we imposed ourselves here. We have been in this neighborhood for over 2 decades. As far as being close to a medical facility, I think one of the unique things about COPE is that we're not a medical facility, and that's not what a lot of these individuals seek out. They seek out our staff, they trust our staff, they listen to our staff, and they're willing to engage in hopefully better practices, and some even agree to go to drug rehab. There are more that would go to drug rehab than actually do, but the one reason they don't is because they have warrants, and if they go into drug rehab, they will be arrested. So the issue is, the root of the problem, as I said again, is not needle exchange. The root of the problem is addiction, how we treat addiction, how we view this, not just in Brockton, but in this country.
I realize. Thank you. And as we were going, can we get back? We were curious about the ages and, you know, if you deal with minors, how that's handled or...
We don't deal with minors. This is an adult population. How the staff actually gets the ages of the individuals, I don't actually have that detail, but if you'd like, I could get that for you.
Okay, because we would be curious, because we realize that a majority of these individuals do not come from Broughton, and they've come here to receive the services because they're not provided in many of the surrounding communities.
Well, I would probably take exception to that and say that the majority of the people that use the center are actually from Brockton, as far as we can tell. These aren't people that drive up in vehicles. These are people that are generally on the street. Now, so I would say that I would take exception that from all we can ascertain, these are individuals that reside in, or live or walk the streets in Brockton. And I'm not sure where you got that information that most of them come from other towns. And I would also say that the target area for high-risk infection is not in Easton. It's not in Stoughton. Right now, this generally happens to be in urban cities like Brockton, Taunton, Fall River, and Worcester.
No, I understand what you're saying, but it seems that oftentimes these individuals weren't always living in Brockton, and they probably came here due to circumstances and because we have services here in this city.
I'm not sure how you could possibly make that conclusion, but we'll leave it at that.
Okay. Well, for example, though, we were curious about two other things. Is there an examining board that reviews the progress of all the programs like this throughout the state, and are there... how would I say it? Is there a public a report that can be available for the public?
I'm not sure what you mean by an examining board.
Well, someone to see the progress in services. I mean,
the Department of Public Health.
Okay, the Department
oversees
of Public
our program, and we report our results to the department. The department has access to our center anytime that they want. We work in close proximity with the AIDS division at the Department of Public Health.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to defer this to my colleagues.
Councilor Burns.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Simonelli, I just have a few questions. I don't know if I missed it in your opening statement, but this new program that you started to employ at the center started in May.
Yes.
So how did we, is there a grant-funded program? How do we get funding for that? How does the City of Brockton actually have funding for this program to actually be executed?
The City of Brockton does not have funding for this program. This is state funding that goes to our organization, BMZ. The services that we're providing, the people on the street, are being provided free to the City of Brockton. So it is not appropriated through the city.
Okay, so it's an agreement or some kind of contract between you and...
We have a contractual agreement with the Department of Public Health.
Okay.
To provide the staff to manage and implement and operate the center.
Okay. And you mentioned staff. So you did mention the nurse, and my colleague did. She also mentioned the nurse. So of all of the other programs that you have been providing, in your words, over two decades, anyone else certified for this, or are you using volunteers, or what kind of, I guess, qualifications are the people there? What do they have to help these people with all these myriad of problems?
I didn't come with a listing of all of the staff that we have there.
Do you have like a licensed clinician, a mental health specialist, a drug abuse specialist? Because you only mentioned the nurse.
I would have to get back to you on the details of the staff. I can tell you that the staff at the program, we don't randomly just select. Within the contract that we have with the Department of Public Health, they issue the type of qualifications and the type of individuals. Some are outreach workers. With just experience. Others are bachelor-degreed persons, and we have the availability for mental health services if that's indicated, but we don't provide mental health services at this site. We would be more referring. We work closely with the Brockton Neighborhood Health Center, for example, and any other medical facilities and drug treatment programs to refer people in. So mainly the services that we provide are related to just sort of here and now. It's not a clinically based program.
So for instance, if I were an affected individual, putting myself at risk, I come in with my needle or two or whatever. What happens when I come in there to the time that I leave for this particular program? What services should I expect?
It depends on what you come in for. So, for example, you may come in to be tested anonymously. Our tests are anonymous.
Okay.
So we would have a phlebotomist or a nurse do testing, and that would be for all of the diseases that I mentioned, and including HIV.
Mm-hmm.
We would have some of our workers discuss with you what's going on in your life. We may advise people where to seek services, where to get food. We would then talk to people about what their practices are and try to encourage cleaner, healthier ways of doing things, particularly if they were members of the sex industry. We would want to make sure that they had ample condoms and protection.
Mm-hmm.
So that they would be clean. We often provide dental hygiene because the transmittal of these diseases are oftentimes through blood, so we want to make sure that people have proper dental hygiene, and we sort of recommend that people do proper dental hygiene as well.
Okay, so now you actually just mentioned something else that I didn't even think of. So if people are, kind of taking people's blood and doing these kinds of things, do you have like a bloodborne pathogen certificate and things there, or is that covered with the nurse?
That's covered with the nurse drawing the blood.
Okay.
Because, again, there's high risk involved in this.
Right. For everybody. That's what I'm trying to
correct.
Just talk about, protecting everybody.
Correct.
And
I would also say that the practices of what we're doing in terms of HIV testing and drawing blood is also overseen by the Department of Public Health.
I see. Okay. And yes, you did mention actually the Department of Public Health, and my colleague did mention something that I was going to touch on. So, if the Department of Public Health, you said they come in and they kind of, do their reports and you provide your feedback to them, you said, though, that there's really no way to track where these needles are coming from. So in my mind, I'm thinking, you know, I could get needles from wherever, not necessarily from an exchange program like yours, but I come in and then I get, you know, something in return virtually for a junk product. But how do you report that back? So how do you, how can you, I guess, continue the program and continue the rubrics when you're not sure that what you're giving out is exactly what you're getting back?
Well, our goal is not to get out what we give back. Our goal is to get more. Our goal is to get back what we give out plus pick up needles. So we are hoping over the course of time that our program would be taking dirty needles. Now, I don't think it really, in the true sense of the thrust and mission and purpose of the program, mm-hmm. if you have a dirty needle, and that dirty needle did not come from us, mm-hmm. we want that off the street. We don't want to say, we don't want that dirty needle because we didn't give it to you. So our goal is to remove all dirty needles off the street. Our goal is not to distribute needles to put more on the street. So if we're giving one-to-one, ultimately I would like to see our goal be over the course of long term, to get back the amount of needles that we give out, exactly, and we are very close at this point. Plus, I would like to see our being able to pick up more needles and remove more needles from the streets of Brockton.
And is that pretty much the only requirement for continued funding from the DPH, just to show that you are returning somebody's needles from somewhere to somewhere at some time?
No, in fact, the department doesn't recommend doing a one-to-one exchange.
Okay, so how do you get the money? I thought that's what the program was
for. We don't get the money based on how many needles we return. We get the money based on the cost of the staffing. And frankly, the money that comes into our program mm-hmm. is... from our budget sense, I mean, we're doing this more because we see this as a service. So what we have is what's called a cost reimbursed contract. So we have a list of staff, supplies, and a portion of the building that costs a certain amount of money. We get that back. We don't get any more money for collecting any more needles or less needles, okay. or how many people we serve. We get money. Our funding is based on appropriations to the expenses of the program, the staff, and whatever other expenses. We do not get anything for the needles. That is covered. The needles are sent by the Department of Public Health. We don't get any money for it. We don't buy needles. The number of needles, the amount of people that come in, have no bearing on the amount of money that comes into our agency.
Okay, I understand, okay. And just one more thing. So you said that by the end of the week, you've cataloged up to 500 dirty needles or used needles in the streets. Are they being collected in a centralized area, or is this all over the city? Where
we send people out all over the city and in known areas of the city where we might find needles. We pick them up, we put them in a shop's container, and we return them to the state.
Right, I'm asking where, though. Where are your people? Do you have a log? Do you say, you know, I picked up this needle at blah, blah, and blah,
well,
blah?
Well, I really don't feel comfortable saying exactly where, because, you know, we've been doing this since May, and I would have to really look at, there might have been changes since we've been doing this. I'm happy to tell you where we're looking and what we're doing, but I don't have that information this evening. I don't feel comfortable just making it up.
Oh, okay. All right, so, and just last question. So as I read in the story, and this was a while ago that I read it, and a lot of things have happened since, but it was my understanding that the story in the paper broke, that it was just you can come and you can get needles, as I understand.
Yes.
So what was the confusion then from May to, you know, 2 weeks ago, whenever the story broke, that now it is this kind of reciprocal relationship with the streets and the whole program? What happened from then to 2 weeks ago?
Well, I have to take total responsibility for that.
Okay.
Error.
Thank you.
What happened was, of course, I have staff. Our staff relayed to me that we were doing a needle exchange program. A needle exchange program is a one-to-one needle exchange. So I conveyed that to the city. And I conveyed that in error. Councilor Monahan went down to the program and asked some questions and telephoned me and brought it to my attention. And I looked at more detail and I understood what the discrepancy was. Our people were calling it needle exchange, but what we were actually doing in the first month of the program is syringe distribution. Now, I can tell you that if you look at the literature, the state of the art, the recommendations by the state, that is the way that you can reduce the most infection in a given targeted area. I had a discussion with Councilor Monahan, had a discussion with the mayor, and it was clear the city did not want to proceed with that type of a program. I acknowledged my mistake. I acknowledged it publicly in the newspaper. I acknowledged it on Fox 25 on television. Okay. I'm acknowledging it publicly here tonight.
Okay.
And we took a short period of time and reversed our protocol. I had a conference with the Department of Public Health, told them what the city wanted. There was written correspondence exchanged between the city, Department of Public Health, and the city, saying that they will honor and authorize and support our doing a one-to-one exchange. So we got off to a bad start, and I will take total blame for that.
Right,
it's a point
you.
Of information, just give to Mr. Simonelli that as soon as we did tell him about that, he was on it right away, and they took care of it right away, and everything he said is true, so he stepped up and did the right thing, so just give him credit for that.
Thank you, Councilor.
Okay, great.
Thank you, Councilor.
Thank you, sir, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Azak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Mr. Simonelli.
Good evening.
Some of my questions have already been answered, but since you started this needle exchange program or syringe distribution, whichever it may be, is your staff keeping any sort of data? Is this program working? Are we actually helping people? Are we diagnosing with all these tests that people are taking? Are we diagnosing people? Are we getting them the correct health care that they need? Or,
well, I can tell you this. It's only been a very short period of time. We are collecting data, and I think it's probably a little bit too soon to determine how effective or not effective this particular program is. We do know, as I mentioned earlier, that we've had 32 people agree to go into drug rehab. We also know that there's been 3 cases of HIV that have tested positively. Of the people who signed up for needle exchange, there were a little over 300, and 140 of them agreed to take anonymous HIV tests, so that we know that of those 140, we know that 137 did not have HIV, they did not have hepatitis C, A, or B. We also took the opportunity, and I don't have the numbers with me tonight, to any of those individuals that would agree to get inoculated for hepatitis A and B, we provided that inoculation to them as long as they would allow it. As far as other medical treatment, as I mentioned, we only do very minor first aid types of services for people that might be injured. We do a lot of referral to the Brockton Neighborhood Health Center or other medical facilities that will take them. And as I mentioned, we had a number of other people, and I can't really quantify it for you tonight, that would have been willing to go into drug treatment, that were amenable to it, but have refused because they have a criminal record. And having a criminal record, they would put more than likely be arrested.
Thank you. So with, you know a lot more than I do about this, but with this needle exchange, do you see that it's actually working, that this program is actually helping out? I mean, to me, as I'll be honest, I don't know much about it. And, you know, if you tell me somebody's going to come to your office to give you a needle and to get a different, you know, how do you feel that that helps? That helps people get clean, that helps them actually,
the problem without clean needles is that people keep injecting themselves with dirty needles. Now, the concern about whether there are needles that come back or some other needle, if people using on the street are picking up needles themselves and bringing them back, the more needles they bring back, the more we like it. because they're getting dirty needles off the street. And they know that they're not going to get any more needles than what they bring back. Whether or not the program is effective, whether it's not helping, it has helped some people. So of 300 people that we've seen since May, 10% of them have taken the step to go into drug rehab. I don't know how successful they'll be beyond that. We haven't followed them enough. I could stand here and tell you the program is effective and it's doing great work. But in essence, I think it's a little bit too early to tell whether it's working or whether it's not working. And in this particular program, I think it's important because there's a lot of volatility for the city. There's a lot of volatility for our organization, that it's important that we continue to talk to city officials, evaluate how well or how poorly that we're doing with it, because the bottom line is that it's our goal to provide a service to the city and to make the situation better. And if this program is not making it better or making it worse, then we ought to reevaluate what we're doing with it. So I think it remains to be seen, and it's just only been a short period of time. I have hopes that it will help reduce the needles on the street. But as I mentioned earlier, I think that we're all across this country dealing with a terrible problem of addiction. And heroin is, we've advanced from crack cocaine to heroin. And the big difference is with crack cocaine, you didn't have needles on the street. Now you have needles on the street, so you also have high risk and high incidence of drug addiction. And at the same time, you have a public health nuisance and risk to people that are living in the community. And we identify both of those things, and we really feel that we want to make an impact on both of those problems.
And I do have to say that the city of Brockton, and I have children in the public school system, and for whatever reason around the schools, there tends to be needles. But I know that we're doing a great job cleaning up for the size of the city that we are, and with the many communities that are dealing with this, Brockton's doing a great job. So I want to make sure that I put that out there. I see police officers, public city employees that are constantly cleaning. And I know the mayor's put out a program with anybody that wants training on how to pick up a needle, make sure that nobody gets injured. There's a hotline also that somebody can call if they see a needle. So everything that can be done is being done to try to get the needles off of our streets. But in the beginning, when you first spoke, you mentioned that many of these clients aren't driving up to your office, they're walking up, so that's why they're probably Brockton residents. So is over a lot of them, do you feel a lot of them are probably right there near your office, they live there, are they homeless? Are you dealing a lot with the homeless?
A lot of homeless and a lot of street population that our center has been dealing with for years.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor O'Leary.
Hi, to build off of Councilor Isak's last question, a lot of the people do you keep track, do you ask people where they are, where they're from,
or? A lot of what we do is anonymous service. It's not a clinical program, it's not a doctor's office, because that's the type of service that these individuals generally don't use. It would be a turnoff and they probably would go away. So we don't keep a lot of clinical information, and a lot of our testing is done anonymously.
All right, because I wanted to, what caught my attention earlier was that Councilor Beauregard pointed out a lot of the population in that area, street population, as you put it, a lot of these people originally were not from the city. I want to just clarify that for people at home. They've come here for the aid that we have that other towns and communities do not have. But if you were to look through where people lived prior to Brockton, if you're homeless and you're currently in Brockton, it's very easy to say you're from Brockton. But prior to becoming homeless, a lot of
Council, with all due respect, I'm not sure that I know enough about the population to determine where they lived before. And I think we are lucky to have a city that cares about its people. We are lucky to have a city that provides service. I've been working here for over 40 years because I love this city. And I will tell you that, as I mentioned earlier, many of the same services that we have here in Brockton are in other communities like Brockton, Fall River, Taunton, New Bedford, Worcester, Boston. Boston's been doing needle exchange long before we have. Worcester has been doing needle exchange long before we have. And the services in those cities are rich because the state, when it provides service, doesn't identify that we're going to give all these services to Brockton and not give them to Fall River or Taunton or those other towns.
I'm not suggesting Fall River or Worcester. I don't think there's any somebody who's got an opiate addiction or is homeless trying to make it from Worcester to Brockton. You use Taunton. Taunton borders Newton to the same or similar degree that Brockton shares a relationship with Easton. The people from Norton who become homeless or develop an addiction and need the services that Taunton offers will go to Taunton. Same as the people from Easton, the Bridgewaters, Avon, Abington would come to Brockton.
Well, theoretically, I think I can see your point, but factually, I'm not sure how I would actually track those numbers and make that hard and fast conclusion. I will say that I think a lot of the problems that we have here in Brockton with this population, I don't think it's unique to Brockton. I think that this is an urban problem.
I agree it is regional and certainly becoming a national epidemic.
Mm-hmm.
I do have to say, I don't have any concrete statistics to point to. The nature of this kind of situation really is not helpful for pointing out solid numbers, but it does, in my opinion, from where I look at it, it's something the city, it's an increase. If we didn't have as much of the things we did, we wouldn't see that same number of addicted people or homeless people. I'm not saying that it's a bad thing that we have these things. I just want to clarify for those in the audience and those at home that this is not just a Brockton problem. This is a regional problem that's taking place in Brockton.
It's a regional problem that's taking place across the region in urban cities.
Yes, I mean the greater Brockton area as a region. Thank you.
Bill said, Councilor Farwell.
Yes, nice to see you after many years, Mr. Simonelli.
Good to see you, Mayor.
We don't call him that in here.
Yeah, don't.
That's kidding. Little levity in the situation.
That's when I was young and foolish. Now I'm old and foolish.
We have other names for him, but we won't go into those.
I just wanted to see him smile.
I guess, first of all, I don't think there's any question that BAMSI does exceptional work. I will tell you, and I'm not blessed with diplomacy, so bear with me, that area you have is not the right area. There's very limited parking in Pleasant Street. You're right across the street from the central fire station. Having vehicles stop to let people out who may want to go in and use your services when you don't know if there might be a call requiring the apparatus to leave. Having people who unfortunately are impaired who may want to meander their way into the center. I just, the mayor and the city council and the redevelopment authority and the director of planning and economic development, we're investing a lot of time and money into hopefully changing the dynamics of downtown, and it's really going to be less than inspirational or inviting if we have that situation downtown where people walk along and perhaps just see one needle. They probably won't come back downtown again. So where am I going with this? In other areas of the country, they've actually set up I don't want to say an isolated area, but there's a trailer or something where services are offered, and it's a pretty substantially sized trailer, and people can pull up. There's adequate parking. They go in. They still have anonymity. They still have all of the services that you order, but it takes it out of the downtown area in Brockton and might move it to a better location. And so I would say to you that as the program goes forward, I would like to ask you to just consider that. Do what you're doing, but as we work to hopefully change downtown, I think there's several pieces to that puzzle, and one of them is to get the social services to a better area so that we can concentrate on making it attractive and inviting foot traffic and doing all of the things
so,
that other communities do.
So your opinion and my opinion probably doesn't differ that much, and that might surprise you. The reason that we originally put the Cope Center where it is 20 years ago was because that wasn't an area that was being redeveloped in the city. That was a high-risk area. And it was an area that it would give easy access for people to walk in and not be on the streets. Now, if you do what you say you're going to do and that area gets redeveloped and it's not a high-risk area anymore, you're probably right. It's probably not an area that we should be in. Right now, I can't say there's been enough development to make that consideration, but certainly we would look at it. We want this center to be in a high-risk area. I'm not sure a trailer is the right answer, but I do know that if we look back and think about why we put it there because that gave us the best chance to reach this population. If that no longer is relevant, then we probably don't want to stay there. So I think nature and future city developments will dictate that and will be in line with that. And I want to say one other thing. This is a very controversial program. There's absolutely no question about it. And I really feel there's been a great dialogue here tonight, for sure. But I would hope that at some point we would look at the fact that we are not here to do something that is going to cause problems in the city. We're here to try to help remediate this problem in the city. We're on the same side of the fence here. So if you're saying, would we continue to be stubborn and stay in a well-commercial area that's not high risk and in the plank in the middle of downtown? No, we wouldn't want to do that. That doesn't serve our program. So I don't think we're that far afield from it. So the answer to your question is, yes, we will constantly reevaluate that. And if that area isn't high risk anymore, we'll consider to put it in a high risk area.
Yeah, and I'm not suggesting this be done in 6 months, but I think as things evolve, I think you have to be sensitive and we have to, you know, raise the issue of let's try to locate in a different area where you can still do what you do, but it doesn't negatively impact the downtown area. That's
I'm very sensitive to that.
I thank you for that. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you. Anyone else before I go back to Council Borrio? Council Monahan.
Yes, thanks, Mr. Mitchell. Yes, and also, just as far as the development, we are just, actually, we'll probably be meeting on this tonight about on Pleasant Street. They're putting in luxury apartments right on the edge of Perkins Park. So sooner than later, I would think that we are developing downtown, and I hope you'll be working possibly with our city planner as the urban development and what have you, and you can work together with him figuring out where the best place to move when that time has to come or what have you. One more thing. As you are picking up these needles, do you have staff from that office picking them up, or do you have
there are staff from the center that go out with containers and pick up the needles.
Okay, and if they're getting 500, if you could add another guy or something, might be good to help us out a little bit.
Well, that was one of the things that this money came with, because there's an identification, as I mentioned, that these people are not necessarily as consistent as necessary.
Right. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Council Beauregard, you can wrap this up.
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Now, Mr. Simonelli, thank you again for coming this evening and addressing some of our questions. Now, this is a question because I'm not sure I completely, how would I say, if this is misinformation or what. Am I to understand that some people are provided with the tools to, how would I say, make the drug, prepare the drug?
Yes.
So they receive those at
they can.
The Hope Center?
They can. They don't always, but they can. And the reason for that is that the hepatitis C virus can live outside the body for 3-4 days. The paraphernalia that's used to prepare drugs can carry high risk for disease, and so consequently, we do make that available.
Thank you.
That it?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, yes.
Entertain a motion?
Yes, a motion to move favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Recommend favorably to the full City Council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Mr. Simonelli, thank you, and thank you for all
thank
the
you.
Does for the city. I would now entertain a motion to take item number 26 out of order.
Second. Yeah. Sorry, so moved.
Make a motion.
Motion to take 26 out of order.
Motion made and seconded to take item number 26 out of order. Madam Clerk, can you read the order, please?
Resolved that the mayor be invited to appear before a committee of this council to review the expenditure for payment tuition and other fees for the mayor at Massasoit Community College from the city budget and to bring with him any and all documents related to such expenditure, including any supporting authorization for such expenditure. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Mary Lynn Peters, Chu, City Auditor.
Councilor Ranieri.
Thank you. If I might, Mr. Chairman, appreciate it. Good evening, Mr. Mayor.
Good evening, Councilor.
Again, I just want to make a point that this is another item that was reviewed by the Accounts Committee a few weeks ago at the same meeting when we had the other issue before us. And at that same time, the committee had some concerns to the appropriation coming out of the city budget in regards to the mayor taking a course at Massasoit Community College. So. Again, a motion was made and seconded that we bring it before the City Council and that we review it, and that's where we are this evening with it. Again, no personal insight to anything in regards to you personally, Mayor, but I believe that the committee felt that at this particular time we were just concerned with the fact that you were doing something that was probably more or less in the best interest of yourself, naturally, and the fact that the money was being spent within that account. We felt that the best way, and I too, as a member of that committee, just felt that we would see it appropriately more so if it was coming out of a campaign account or another account, your personal account. We just felt that it wasn't an item that should be coming out of the city budget. And pretty much in a way of looking at it in fairness to other types of appropriations that we don't allow other employees to do within the same. So that's why it's here before us this evening. I know some other committee members may want to speak on it, but that's the discussion that I guess we'll center upon, Mr. Mayor, and appreciate you being here to talk about it with us. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Sure. If you want to...
Sure, if you'd like me to provide a brief explanation, and then I'll be happy to entertain questions. So quite simply, this is a single class, a continuing ed class at Massasoit Community College. It's designed to help you learn just some basic phrases and really basic communication, along with also learning more about there's some cultural aspect to it also, learning how to even, part of it is learning the pronunciation, the changes in pronunciation, and some of them are a little awkward if you've been reading and pronouncing English for 60 years and now look at letters that are combined together and pronounced differently. Quite simply, the purpose of my taking this class is to improve my ability to serve a large percentage of the folks who live in the city. And like plenty of other things that I do and others do to improve their job performance, I felt that for me, working with regularly the largest community here in the city now, that it was important for me to gain some of these basic skills. So it is directly related to me improving my job skills, improving my ability to serve the people of this city, to serve all the people of this city. And I didn't just throw the expense in. I vetted it out at the time with both the auditor and the CFO, who both agreed with me that it was an appropriate expense for me to submit. So The cost is slightly over $500. I'm sure one of you guys has the purchase order. I don't, but it was $500 and some odd. And in the scheme of a $400 million operating budget, I don't think it's a big item. I think it's a totally appropriate expenditure. And I'm more than willing to entertain your questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Some other members of the committee may have some other questions before. All right, thank you.
I have a feeling Councilor Farwell next.
Yeah, I always get into these things. Mr. Mayor, the scrutiny would be offered to Mayor Balzotti, Mayor Harrington, Mayor Units. You just happened to be in office at the time when this crossed our desk. The issue isn't the class. The issue is that you and all of us here and the school committee, we're ordinanced people. And by that I mean we get the salary that's set by the city council, we get the benefits that are set by the city council, and there is no tuition reimbursement. If I were to adopt your position, you would be able to say, well, I think I'm gonna take a class at the Fletcher School of Diplomacy and International Relations. I think I'm going to go to the Sloan School of Management and take a management course. I'm gonna take a course at Harvard School of Public Health in environmental or biological sciences. And frankly, under Chapter 268A, Section 23, the state ethics laws, you are entitled to benefits that are offered to similarly situated people, which is all of us in the school committee, but you can't use your position to enhance the benefits that you receive. And look, I can't tell you not to do it. I can only tell you I don't think it's legal. I think it reflects poorly on the office of mayor, that I think some expenses should necessarily come out of our campaign funds.
I think the word you use in the newspaper is unethical, Counselor.
It is unethical. I'm not going to mince any words.
I couldn't disagree with you more.
Well, I'm sure you do. But I do think it's unethical. And I think that a person who is well compensated, anyone who occupies the office of mayor, who is well compensated, who is an ordinanced employee, who has a specific budget with line items, who knows that the city council sets the parameters for ordinanced employees in terms of the benefits and the salaries and wages that they're entitled to, should abide by that. And if we had sufficient revenue in this city, we'd probably send the planning board and the license commission and the conservation commission and the board of zoning appeals, because every time they meet, they interact with that substantial population that you mentioned. So if we had the money, we'd probably pass an ordinance and ask you for an appropriation and send them to a language class. But it's just not appropriate for any mayor to sit back and say, well, you know, I need this because it's going to help me to be a better mayor. You take what you're given, I would say be thankful for it, and then stay away from the other stuff. Don't live on the edge with this stuff. It just, in my opinion, and I won't speak for anyone else, it's just unethical.
Well, that's your opinion, Counselor, and obviously I sought out the opinion of both the auditor and the CFO before I submitted the expense. I don't agree with some of your analogies either. I think I work for the people of the city. I don't think I work for the council or anyone else. I believe I work for the residents of the city. And about 40% of them speak Cape Verdean Creole, and I don't. And so I'm not looking to become fluent. This is not a personal improvement class. This is to achieve some basic skills to help me do my job better. And I don't think it's any different than any other class that I would take to obtain some basic skills to help me do my job better. We are a multicultural, multilingual city nowadays. This is by far the most common language in the city after English. And I think that there's a real benefit to all of the community here in the city that I'm able to do a better job interacting with that community if I can have some basic command of a few phrases, understand some simple conversation, understand how the language works, and I'm not seeking degree credits, I'm not seeking any personal benefit. This was simply to acquire some skills, a continuing ed class at the local community college, to obtain some basic skills to help me improve in doing my job. I try to improve at doing my job every day, and I think that this is one way in which I will be able to improve a little bit. And so, you know, I think we'll just respectfully agree to disagree.
We will. I would say that all of us might benefit from learning another language, but unfortunately, we can't walk in and tell the city clerk, I'm going to Massasoit, pay for it. And I will say to you, I'm genuinely saddened that you have the position that you do, that you think you can simply decide that, well, I need this to improve my job as mayor and pass the costs on to the
Well, I don't residents. Think I simply decided, as I mentioned, Councilor. I consulted with both the auditor and the chief financial officer of the city before I submitted the expense, and they both signed off on it.
Well, then I
respectfully... So apparently your opinion differs from theirs also. Right.
I suspect a higher authority will review this. So.
I look forward to it.
Anyone else? Councilor Barnes.
So I have several questions about the course. Hello, Mr. Mayor. Good evening.
Good evening, Councilor.
Happy belated birthday as well.
Actually, my birthday's coming up on Sunday. I got the party a little early.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry I missed it.
I have a few days left.
Oh, okay. How long have you been in the class?
Mid-September.
Okay. All right. And
a few weeks. Half a dozen classes.
Okay. Is it just one
eight classes,
course, or is it like a continuing one and two part? Or
It's one class.
Okay. And when is it held?
Thursday nights.
Thursday nights. Okay. And in the Brockton campus, Middleborough?
Brockton.
Okay. So I guess to kind of piggyback a little bit on what Councilor Farrell said. So when I heard that this was coming up, because I was out of town, I thought about it. And I mean, there'd been some opportunities where I wanted to take some classes as well at Massasoit just for my own education in hopes to, you know, do some of the things that I do a little bit better and just being more accessible and just more efficient at my duties as being a counselor. But I never thought to actually take the class unless I was willing to pay the tuition or, you know, made the time. So if this were something that the council were to, I guess, entertain, and I don't even know if this is even something possible, if ethics is going to come into it and take a look at it, but would this be something that could, I guess, be transferred over or to go into some kind of work incentive situation? For instance, like some of the departments, they have a language incentive position. I don't know if we have it here, but there are some places where if somebody learns a language, there's a financial incentive, the degree program with the police, things like that. Is that something where this is looking to go?
No.
Information on that, those would be negotiated union by union and individual, something
Well, not
like
for
that.
Us and not the mayor.
Exactly, but with any other department, it would be negotiated in their contract.
No, I know, but that's why I'm asking for us. I'm not asking about.
No,
I'm just mentioning the other departments
right,
have those things. So would that be something? Is
no
what
idea.
I'm asking.
I think that the concern around is this for my personal enhancement. I think that if I went to take a class in Japanese, that would be a very valid criticism, and I wouldn't have even considered submitting the cost of the class in my expense account or in my budget. However, this particular case, I simply am looking to the local community college to gain some additional skills to help me do my job better, to improve my performance, and to truly try to represent all of the people in the city. And more than a third of the folks in this city speak Cape Verdean Creole. I don't, and I think the time had come for me to obtain some basic understanding. That's all. One class, $500. Everybody can weigh in on it. I did, again, vet it out with the CFO and the auditor, and had they had an objection, I would not have submitted it.
Any interest in taking a Haitian Creole class or an American Sign Language or basic skills Spanish class? I'm just saying, I mean, those are the other languages that
so,
are spoken
right.
here.
Right, so if we want to get into this much detail on this, I think that one of the reasons I thought this would be helpful to me is that earlier in my life, and it's been a while, but I have studied both Spanish and French earlier in my life, and so I can read a little bit, and I can understand a little bit, and I catch on much easier. I've never studied Portuguese or Creole, and it's different, in particular the Creole. And I thought this was a perfectly legitimate expense. We have in the budget, Mayor's Goods and Services, it's over $100,000 line item. There's a line item in there for registrations, subscriptions, and something else.
Travel.
Separate from travel, not travel. But it's a line item that was consistent with this type of expense. I didn't take it out of the fire department. There's a line item in my budget. Matter of fact, hang on a second. Let me get it right. Registrations, memberships, and subscriptions. And that's within Mayor's Goods and Services, which is like $124,000 item in my budget. It's a $500 expense, one class, local community college. Give me some basic skills. I think it'll make me a better mayor. I think it's a good investment for $500.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Lally.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor.
Good evening, Councillor.
I have to say, as a college student, when I first heard about this, I said, all right. I do have to say, and this is...
I wish you had taken the class. You could help me with my homework.
You know, I got to say, languages... I was never good at languages. Scrape by. And this is... This is sort of channeling my parents here, but how are your grades?
Well, this is the only class I'm taking. The semester's not over yet, and I'm struggling a little bit, to be honest with you. But I'm getting some extra help. That's what you do when you struggle with the class.
There you go. All right, thank you.
Right. And this is not going to a whole series of classes. This is one basic class, one time, $500, that I thought would be helpful to me. It's actually extra work and even more pressure on my time. And as I say, I'm putting some extra time into it because I think it's worthwhile.
Councilor Azak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Mayor.
Good evening.
My question is actually for, well, the CFO isn't on the list, but he is invited.
If there's no objection, we'll allow the CFO to answer a question.
And Marilyn. But I'm not sure if Ms. Chu was the auditor at the
no.
time.
She no. wasn't.
So the question would be to...
No, it was Heidi Churchill at the time.
Mr. Condon, so when has this has anything similar to this happened in past administrations? I don't think any of our previous mayors went back to take some classes, but was there ever a questionable expense similar to this?
Questionable expense? Well, I don't find this particularly questionable. I think it has a direct relationship to the mayor's ability to serve the Cape Verdean population.
I agree with you.
I don't remember another mayor having taken a course like this, no.
Now, and the mayor mentioned that he has this line item in his budget. What have the funds in these line items been used for in the past with previous administrations?
Well, the council sets an appropriation at the goods or the services level. The rest of that information in the budget is subject to the discretion of the department head to move within that appropriation because the breakdown of that appropriation is basically for accounting purposes. So he has pretty much full discretion within the goods and services appropriation to spend it on a legitimate public purpose. I do think there's a public purpose in this case. I wasn't asked about enrolling. I mean, it was after the enrollment took place that he asked for my advice, but I don't see it as a problem. I don't think it would be appropriate if you weren't taking a class that's directly related to such a large portion of the population, a large immigrant population. But he's able to move the money around within that appropriation to any of those object codes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just had a quick question. First of all, thank you for being here tonight. And I mean, I concur with you that learning a language of a vast majority of the residents in the city of Brockton makes sense. And $500 is a blip on a $400 million budget. Mm-hmm. But I guess I question the idea. You're a politician. We're all politicians. $500 is a legit, under Mass General law, is a legitimate campaign expense. So to avoid all this finger-pointing and unethical and ethical, why wouldn't you just take it from your campaign treasure, write $500 out, it's a legitimate expense? Why wouldn't you have just done that?
Well, I think that was an option, and I think it's an option I'd consider again in the future. I mean, as I said, I looked at it as being a legitimate expense within the budget. If I mean, the only people I'm hearing complaints from so far are city councilors.
You're not getting the calls we're getting.
Huh?
You're not getting the calls we're getting.
Then tell them to call my office.
I will.
Tell them to call my office. As a matter of fact, I've had more than half a dozen calls in the past week of people calling up and offering to pay for the class, so you guys will leave me alone. So,
this is what I want to say. It's not to leave you alone. It's and Mr. Fowle says this almost every week. I mean, we're the stewards of the finances of the city of Brockton. So it's a blip, $500. And I do want to say thank you to the chair of the accounts committee for bringing this to our attention. But again, I mean, we can argue all day. Is it in the budget? Tuition line item is not in the budget. You're the mayor. Jay works for you. Mel works for you. I get it. But I think at the end of the day, when you're learning a language, then you have to take into consideration other languages because there are other populations in the city of Brockton.
Absolutely.
And I guess the issue is future mayors. This could open up.
Napoli.
Quiet down, please.
It's working. This could open up the floodgates of future mayors or city councilors or school committee members. And I think that's what the gist of tonight is. Again, you did what you did. You're the mayor. I understand that. I think to avoid this, maybe in the future, you go to your campaign manager, you get 500 donations all the time. You just write it out and be done with it. So thank you for being here tonight. Mr. Chairman.
Councilor, in retrospect, had I thought it would really be a controversial issue or that people would have an issue with it, probably what I would have done.
Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Mayor, good evening.
Good evening.
How's the classes?
It's harder than I thought it was going to be, and I'm getting some extra help, but I'm, you know, phrase by phrase, learning a little bit.
Say anything yet?
Clean.
Como busta?
Tudo direitinho.
Ami está bom. Obrigado.
Ami em questão tudo direito. I'm just...
Ami começa aula recente. So...
I'm just going to translate what he said. He said that the city council has some serious issues.
Tu papio inglês. Tu papio inglês.
Okay. Mr. Mayor, I think I speak perhaps unlike some of the other folks in this body, in a sense. I come across speaking various different languages. I mean, we talk about bilingual types, bilingual kids, bilingual kids, bilingual kids. Some of us, and there's quite a few people here in the audience that actually can attest to this, I learned English as my fifth language. Not as a first, a second, a third, a fourth, as a fifth language. So I'm one of those that always encourage people to get out and learn other languages, because there's a tendency here in the United States to look at folks that are bilingual, multilingual, as being less than or not as intelligent as some other ones who speak it without an accent or take a while to communicate what they want to say. But contrarily, when you look at it, in most places in the world, languages are appreciated and languages are encouraged. They don't look at people who are multilingual as less than, so it's nice to see that, honestly, a person like yourself is stepping out and taking this particular course. Because I do believe that as the chief executive officer of the city, it makes sense to be able to communicate across lines. But I do have to sound the caution that my colleague at large, Sullivan, actually brought up, Council Sullivan. You know, it's $500. You know, you earn $150,000 a year.
$140, $141.
Did you get a cut in the budget or something?
No, $142. I don't know.
But
I know I didn't get a raise.
Honestly, I would not put myself in that position to stand here in front of this body to discuss $500. You know, when in fact that you earn a decent salary, you do have a campaign account that you could have taken the $500 out of, so to avoid this entire hoopla about this, because what I actually got out of this thing, believe it or not, is, and I know that we are now living in a country that that takes an issue with immigrants and people that come from other places. You wouldn't believe the amount of backlash that I personally have gotten from pushing forward a simple act called the Trust Act in this city. I've received phone calls in the worst way you can think of, questioning everything from my patriotism down to my ability to wear a tie that resembles an American flag to a variety of other issues, only because I'm standing to defend those that might not be able to defend themselves. So what I actually witness in this whole discussion about your classes is not the fact that you're taking a class to help you do your job a little bit better, but the fact that you are taking a class to help Cape Verdeans. And there's this infinite hatred, in a sense, towards Cape Verdeans in this community. I hear it every day. I see it every day. Anytime something comes up that somebody says, I'm doing something for Cape Verdeans, we tend to forget the benefits that Cape Verdeans are bringing into this community. You know, and
Point of order, Mr. Chairman, please, because we're taking it down a whole nother route.
Yeah. Finish.
We brought this issue before the council to be discussed because we felt that it was appropriate. That's what the Accounts Committee has done. And I'm going to say it. The Accounts Committee is going to be working feverishly over the next month, and even hopefully it'll be the same Accounts Committee next year, in making sure that if we have questions about these types of expenditures, we're going to bring them to the floor, we're going to bring them to the council floor. And if people do not like it, I'm sorry, but that's the job that we're going to do. Get over it, everyone. It's a new world, and that's how it's going to be working.
Counselor, that's not a point of information.
My point of information is going to be that I'm going to now make a motion that I move this unfavorably back to the full city council.
Second.
You don't have the floor, Counselor. Counselor Rodriguez has the floor.
I don't know if the councilors actually know this, but I earned this seat. I was voted like everybody else, and I earned this seat to be here.
Let's stick to the issue that's before us.
I think if I have an issue that I want to express, I should be able to express it. I know I don't have all the privileges that come along with the privilege types, but I think I've earned this
Counselor.
Seat. I was put here with
Counselor.
This. So let me continue.
Get to the resolve, please.
So the reason why I bring this up is because I see the backlash that's actually coming forward in terms of the fact that you're picking up this language. And if you had not used the funds from the budget itself to pay for this class, none of this stuff would have been happening. So I'm actually leaving this on a positive note to tell you that perhaps in the future, and I encourage you to continue doing this because I think it's that important in this community, and I urge all my colleagues to do that, to basically use funds until such time that funds are appropriated for others to do the same thing, to use your own campaign funds to do that. So we wouldn't have to sit here and actually hurt communities that don't deserve hurting. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Counselor.
Can I just respond briefly to Councilor Rodriguez?
Quickly, please.
I will very quickly, Counselor. I'll tell you one positive experience that has come out of this for me is I think in just a few weeks I have gained a much greater appreciation for people who have learned to speak other languages, particularly as an adult. And I have a lot of friends who speak two or three languages. Many of them learn to speak other languages as adults. And I think I have a much greater appreciation of how much work it is and how big that challenge is, having gone through this exercise with this class.
Thank you.
Councilor Fowle?
Mr. Chairman, I would say to my good friend who's at large, Councilor Rodriguez, I certainly hope the mention of hatred towards the Cape Verdeans wasn't at all directed at me as a member of the Accounts Committee. My son's fiancé happens to be Cape Verdean. What we're talking about and what we should be talking about is not a language class. We're talking about ethical behavior. And I know people don't want to get into it, but when that money was spent from the city treasury, that's not why it was appropriated. And if Mr. Condon has the official position that the mayor, or I suppose any department head, can simply decide they need to take a class to enhance their job skills and better represent the city of Brockton in their respective positions, and we have to pay for it, then I guess we're going down an entirely new budget line that I've never seen. It certainly didn't come up when I was in office, and I'm sorry if he has come over to that side of thinking. In my view, it shouldn't have been done. As Councilor Sullivan said, $580. Come on, people. We pay for it ourselves, or we pay for it out of our campaign account. And if that rubs people the wrong way, I'm not going to apologize. I'm going to stand with the residents of this city who expect to see, whether it's $580 or $5,000 or $50,000 spent for their benefit, everyone's benefit. In this country, one person is important. It's nice to pander and say, well, I'm going to learn this language because 40% of the people speak it. Well, you know what? Maybe only 20% speak Spanish, but they're just as important as anyone else. There may only be 5% of the people who speak an Oriental language. They're still just as valuable to this community as anyone else. They're a part of Brockton and they're a part of America. So we can spin it that we're taking a class, we can spin it that we're improving our job skills, but the fact of the matter is that's not fair to the residents of this city. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Ranieri, you want to make a motion?
Move for an unfavorable recommendation.
Second.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to send this back to the City Council unfavorably. All those in favor? Hold your hands up, please.
Chairman, I'd like the roll call vote on this.
Madam Clerk, can you call a roll, please? Again, a yes vote is to send it back unfavorably. That's actually an incorrect motion. I'm going to ask you to make a motion favorable in the hopes it does not prevail. You cannot make a negative recommendation. So your motion needs to be favorable in the hopes it does not prevail.
Favorable in the hopes it does not prevail.
Second.
All right, there's a motion made and seconded. So councilors, just so you know, a yes vote is for a favorable recommendation back to the full City Council. A no vote expresses that you want it to go back with an unfavorable recommendation. Madam Clerk, please call a roll.
Excuse me. I don't think I understand that logic. Wouldn't it be the other way around? We would vote yes to have it go back unfavorable. No, to have it...
No, the motion is favorable because you can only make a positive recommendation. Councilor Ranieri's motion is to send it back favorably, although his motion expresses that he hopes it does not prevail.
Right,
so
if I say no...
So a yes vote is for the motion. A yes vote is to send it back favorably.
Motion to recommend favorably, yes or no?
No.
When you get there, if you want it to be no, you'll vote no.
In the hopes it does not prevail, that's what he said.
Correct.
He's saying he doesn't want it to pass.
I want the no to prevail.
He's saying he doesn't want it to pass.
All right, I'll figure it out.
You can't do the if it prevails or not until the council meeting.
Right.
So it's just going to be...
The chairman, I call the vote.
Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Shirley Azak.
Yes.
Shayna Barnes.
Do you want to express your displeasure?
Favorable. I want this to be favorable.
Then you want to vote yes.
Yes.
Ann Beauregard.
No.
Timothy Cruz.
Yes.
Dennis Ranieri.
No.
Winthrop Farwell.
No.
John Lally.
Yes.
Tom Monahan.
Yes.
Moises Rodriguez.
Yes.
Paul Studensky?
Yes.
Robert Sullivan?
No.
Recommended favorably to the full City Council. Madam Clerk, we're back to item number 6, please.
Okay. Total blank.
Order appropriation of $350,000 from unappropriated estimated receipts of the general fund for fiscal year 2017. To personal services overtime. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, John Crowley, Police Chief.
Councilors, we're going to take a 1 minute recess. Yeah. Anybody who wants to leave?
to be doing that.
Councilors, we're back in session. Ma'am, can you get behind the railing, please? Ma'am, can you get behind the railing, please? We're back in session.
We'll talk later.
Mr. Condon, we're back in session.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Farwell.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to move to postpone this to the next Finance Committee meeting, and I'd like to be heard on the motion.
Your motion, you have the floor right now. So your motion is anonymous.
I would second that.
Motion made and seconded.
Chairman, was it even read?
It was read.
It was read.
Before I took the recess.
Thank you.
That's why I took the recess. You couldn't even hear it being read. So, Councilor Fowle on the motion.
Councilors, I am not opposed to a supplemental overtime appropriation for the police department. However, I did distribute an Excel spreadsheet with a formula, and I asked for a breakdown of not only how much overtime was spent, but I wanted it by rank. In other words, how much have we expended between July 1st and October 31st for captains, for lieutenants, for sergeants, for detectives and patrolmen? Now, the reason I did that is because at a recent ward meeting with Council Monahan, some residents asked, why don't we have walking beats? And the police chief's response was that the overtime budget was cut. We left, after that cut, $1,090,000. So I think it's prudent for us to know exactly where the money has been spent in order to make an informed decision on how much money is going to be needed through the end of the fiscal year. And I don't think having a counselor submit that kind of a request for some level of detail is at all out of order. So for that reason, I'd like to give the administration additional time to come forward with the information so that all of us know exactly where we stand, exactly where the money has been spent, and we can make a decision on going forward for the remainder of the fiscal year. Thank you.
Motion's been made and seconded to postpone till the next finance meeting. All those in favor? Opposed? Postpone till the next finance meeting. Item number 7, please.
Order appropriation of $367,000 from unappropriated estimated receipts of the general fund for fiscal year 2017 to non-net school spending. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Kathleen Smith, J.D., School Superintendent.
Good evening, Mr. Condon.
I think the school superintendent is here to speak on this as well. I want to make a comment about process as opposed to the substance of this. We're asking for appropriations tonight, including the one that was just postponed, of a significant amount of money in order to set the tax rate with these appropriations coming from the tax levy. We'll be setting the tax rate soon. I think the certification from the Department of Revenue was received by the assessors today. That means that the last opportunity we will have to appropriate funds from the levy itself, as opposed from reserves, would be to make these appropriations tonight. So the $350,000, if it ultimately is acted on favorably, it would have to come from reserves, and this appropriation isn't even to go into the reserves to make it available later. With respect to this particular one, most of these appropriations are coming from three sources, basically. One, the mayor submitted a balanced budget that the city council cut, so there were funds available within that balanced budget from the cuts. Not all of those were reappropriated, so there's some funds left from that source. Two, the final state budget was adopted after the budget was established. There were some additional funds for the school department in there, but there were also reductions in other parts of the cherry sheet to the rest of the city budget. Those had to be made up. And then finally, we always estimate the amount of tax levy growth at the beginning of the process conservatively, and we had several hundred thousand, I think about $700,000 additional that came in with the final certification. So that combination of city council cuts, changes in the cherry sheet, especially for education, and the tax levy growth, net of the appropriation steps that you've already taken, leaves the amount of money that's in front of you tonight for being appropriated. These monies, if they're going to be used from the tax levy, need to be set and have been appropriated before we actually try to set the tax levy. So that's just as information. This particular one, I think the school superintendent can handle pretty well, but basically it's going to be used to provide additional funding for their school buses so that we'll have enough money to transport the kids for the balance of the year.
Move favorable recommendation.
Second.
On the motion, actually,
Councilor Barnes.
Superintendent Smith, if I could. So is this for the charter school kids or homeless, McKinney, like, what is this funding for?
Right. I think the way to explain it is, with our non-net school spending, we were close to $1 million short of what we had requested. Uh-huh. And of course, we're estimating, you know, transportation,
mm-hmm.
because of the things you just mentioned. The charter school coming in, we weren't sure of the location, whether you're talking about the number of homeless students that we're serving. So at this point here, the $367,000 would be the money that we would need to get through, we're still estimating, but for the rest of this year, for transportation.
Okay, and that's district-wide?
Correct, that's district-wide.
Okay.
And again, some of the amounts of money, we're actually seeing a change in the homeless population, and that's a positive for our families. They're being placed in homes. I think you're understanding that the hotels are reducing the number of children at the hotels, reducing, and that, not just in Brockton, I'm talking hotels in Fall River, you know, hotels, you know, throughout the state, where we're actually transporting kids back and forth, sometimes hours on the buses. Oh, so that's good news for everybody. We're able to reduce that item from about $900,000, almost $1 million, down to $600,000 for this year. So we're trying to make up that million that we were short.
Mm-hmm.
But again, in trying to make that up, we still need the $367,000 for all of the busing for our students in the city.
Okay, and I seem to remember, I'm not sure if I dreamed this up, but wasn't there some kind of statewide initiative or even district-wide initiative to address some of the McKinney-Vento stuff or some litigation that was going on at one time to kind of, you know, take care of this pitfall for public schools and homeless children transportation stuff? Was that a thing?
Well, money does come into the city for McKinney-Vento, but it comes into the city, and usually the council, the mayor, has been good enough to give it to the schools to use for our transportation for that very cost. Oh. I'm not sure if that's what you're talking about. The state auditor, I know, reviewed the transportation, the homeless transportation, and the cost being borne by cities.
But I thought there was something kind of like the Webby case and things. There was a deficit in kind of the urban districts and having to go out so far to pick up kids, and it wasn't kind of gelling, and the districts were being unfairly sacrificed, I guess, for that stuff.
Certainly.
Was there ever like state litigation for that?
There has been a burden on the city at this point here. What we did get this year, we got $100,000 extra dollars from our legislators in the state budget that
okay.
was passed in August. I know there's been talk about it. As I said, I think the state auditor has reviewed it.
Okay.
But at this point here, I'm not sure of any settlement.
Okay. I thought I heard it, but I wasn't sure. Thank you.
Motion been made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you, Madam
Thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman? The superintendent has another agenda item. I believe it's number 18, and rather than have her remain, I'd like to move that we take it out of order and
Second.
Allow her to.
Motion made and seconded to take it number 18 out of order. All those in favor? All those opposed? Madam Clerk, please read number 18.
Resolved, the City Council of the City of Brockton requests the city's legislative delegation to file and support legislation which would allow communities with an enrollment of 10,000 students to file a preliminary enrollment report on October 1st of each calendar year, so as to assure the proper level of state aid for the support of the school district. Invited Mark Gilday, Legislative Counsel, Kathleen Smith, JD, School Superintendent.
Councilors, by the way, Mr. Gilday was invited on, I believe that was just an error. He wouldn't have anything to do with this, so he did call me today to let me know that he wasn't going to be here unless we needed him, but I believe that was a mistake. Madam Superintendent.
Yes. I'm very pleased to actually see this resolve. When you think back to, and I've had conversation with you about the Chapter 70 Review Commission, and one of the things that Brockton did, this goes back a couple of years ago, when they were looking for information from different school districts as to how to fix the funding formula. One of the things that Brockton went forth with, as did many other urban districts because of the change in our population, it is not necessarily a stable population on October 1st. And that is the date where we have to give our pupil enrollment, which is the funding for our school district, and we rely on that very heavily.
So one of our recommendations was to look at more a midpoint, February, March, where we have pretty much a stable population that we can count on, you know, for educating that next year when the funding comes in. And there are times that that swing from October 1st even to March 1st is close to an additional 200-300 students. If you look at the towns that surround us, there's much more stability on October 1st. The other thing that's very frustrating to urban districts is many times, whether it's a charter, whether it's another school system, you know, on that October 1st date, they've met their business plans, and quite often we will find students coming back to us October 2nd, October 3rd, and continuing on. So I think that is a fair estimate, that if you have students for the full year, if you look at that March date or February date, or whatever we're able to do, I think it will help stabilize our budget or our planning for the next year.
Councilor Farwell.
Yep, very briefly, I file this because of remarks that you made back in, I think, February, and I'd like to see this work its way through the legislature, and I think you may be able to network with some of the other school districts and have their reps and senators sign on and help us out a little bit. So
I'm glad you brought that up, Councilor. On December 2nd, each month I have what they called an urban superintendent network meeting. We get together, and you can imagine with all the changes taking place right now, there's a lot of concern, and concern about funding, concern for support for our students, and we will be talking about ways that we're going to work with our legislators to make sure that we're able to fully fund, you know, urban centers, make sure our children get the education that they certainly deserve.
And councilors, I was remiss in not mentioning, but Vice Chairman of the School Committee, Tom Minicello from Ward 1, is here tonight to show his support for this these last two items. So thank you for being here, School Committeeman Minicello. Any other questions?
Motion to go back to the full City Council favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to send back to the full City Council favorably. All those in favor? All those opposed? So recommended favorably. Thank you
very much.
Well, let me see if I can figure out where we are.
Number 8.
Number 8, please.
Order appropriation of $50,000 from unappropriated estimated receipts fiscal year 2017 of the general fund to the Assessor's Department Ordinary Maintenance Services. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, and John O'Donnell, Chairman of the Board of Assessors.
Good evening, Mr. O'Donnell.
Good evening. This appropriation is to have two fee simple appraisals completed per request of the Department of Revenue during a recent revaluation process. It's for Good Sam and Westgate Mall.
Westgate Mall itself. Okay.
Councilor Rodriguez.
Hey, John. Nice to see you here today. I just have a quick question. Do we do this for all the large commercial businesses?
They just asked to
businesses?
Do the top two taxpayers in the city. They asked us to do the top two taxpayers.
The DOR does that?
Yeah, they did that.
They recommend that you...
They recommend that we do it.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Councilor Farwell.
Just a couple of questions. Why can't we do it in-house? Why can't the board do it?
We're not certified to do fee simple appraisals.
I'm sorry, I missed it because of the background.
They want fee simple appraisals? We do assessments. They're looking for an individual fee simple appraisal by an outside commercial firm.
Okay. The reason I ask that is that when Steward went public in 2010, so about 2011, I think we started taxing them.
Yes.
The city actually hired a firm to come in and do an assessment. And it must have been pretty accurate, because in November of 2014, we actually determined the value of Steward to be overvalued, and we actually rebated to them $45,229 for the main hospital building and $19,251 for the smaller office building. So if in November of 2014 we were precisely able to determine the value of that property to the point where we gave back money to them, what's changed in 2 years?
As I stated to you last meeting I was at, I can't talk about what happened with the abatement process. The Department of Revenue told me, the city solicitor, and the attorney general.
I don't want you to talk about the abatements. I want to know what has happened since November of 2014 that you now require a supplemental appropriation to come in and place a value on the property.
The Department of Revenue wants us to certify that that value, they want an outside appraisal completed to make this.
Okay, and they sent you something in writing?
No. No, they suggested it.
They suggested it?
Yes.
But they didn't mandate it?
Didn't mandate it, no.
Okay, so I go back to my, and I'm actually picking up on something Councilor Rodriguez asked about another appropriation. Why can't we, do we not have people who are capable and certified to do that kind of an evaluation?
Not to do a fee simple appraisal, no.
Fee simple.
That's a complex property. I mean,
well, I understand.
The appraisal that was done before came from a firm in Florida.
Yep, that's right.
It's not something that you can hire a local person. Same with the mall.
Well, we're going to get to the mall in a minute. So it's at least publicly, it's your representation that the Board of Assessors in Brockton is not able to do steward because it's too complex.
No one's certified.
No one is certified.
You have to be a certified commercial appraiser.
Okay. Is there any reason why we don't have one on the board?
I'm certified residential, and Mr. Pike's certified residential.
Okay. Now, of the other commercial properties in the city, are you able to?
We hire Tyler Associates who come in and so, during the reval. They have a commercial assessor. Again, it's not an appraiser, it's an assessor.
So the Board of Assessors basically only takes care of residential property?
No, we take care of both, but we are assisted by their commercial assessor.
Do you know if that's true of other boards, just out of curiosity? I mean,
no, I don't have any factual data.
Well, let's go on to the 540 Westgate Drive, because that's interesting. There's a TIF up there. So you've got a baseline value for that property.
I think that's one of the reasons they want the appraisal done, because that TIF is so old, and they want to just make sure the value is correct.
Right, but don't you have a written agreement that it's...
It's the increment. It's not the baseline, but it's the increment.
Okay. And isn't that... don't we have the capability of taking in that Form 38D, looking at the income and expenditures?
We get that information from them.
Okay, and we can't figure out what the value of the mall is from that?
I'm just going on the recommendation of the Department of Revenue.
Oh, geez, thank God they didn't ask us to do $1 million worth of work. I mean, come on. I'm just astounded that in a city the size of Brockton, we don't have the capability of doing
it. If you gave us more money in our budget, we could do it. We don't have the money. If you want us to hire a commercial assessor, we can do it.
Well,
you got to appropriate.
I would say that's up to you and the mayor, but I would think in this city, particularly where we're going to have hopefully more growth, we would need a commercial assessor.
Growth is all residential.
And I hate to be rude, but at least let me finish before you respond, all right? I would think it would be beneficial to hire a commercial assessor at some point, so maybe you can make that recommendation to the mayor.
Okay, I will.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Sullivan.
Good evening, Mr. O'Donnell. How are you?
Good. Good evening.
I just had a quick question. So the DOR requested it, and it's, I think it's probably a good request. It's probably a little pricey, but it is what it is. In terms of a drop-dead date, since they made a simple request that we should do it, and it's your office and your opinion that it should be done.
Yes.
How quickly would a commercial appraisal be done on those two properties?
We'd probably do them in the spring.
Springtime?
Yes.
And then?
For next fiscal year.
And then that would go back to the DOR. So there's no specific drop-dead date?
No.
Okay. All right. And will that $50,000 probably be used in its entirety?
It could be, yeah.
It could be?
We're going to go through procurement on them, so I'm not.
Okay. It probably wouldn't exceed 50.
No, we'll not exceed 50.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. O'John, I have just questions about the certification. So you have asserted that no one on the board is certified to do these. What is it called again?
It's a fee simple appraisal.
Fee simple
appraisal.
Appraisals. Okay. So
we're certified to do assessments, not appraisals.
Okay. So how much would it cost to maybe get someone that certification, someone that already serves now? Would it be something, like a course or a series of courses that would allow them to be an in-house?
It would take about 3 or 4 years.
Appraiser? Okay. And how much would that be about, do you know?
About $5,000.
Ooh. Okay. So this is a one-time $50,000 fee we could exchange for a $5,000 maybe... $1,000 every year recertification or something? Is that what I'm to understand?
No, but the person would have to have commercial background.
Is that hard to find?
There's a difference between a commercial assessor and a commercial appraiser.
Right, no, I'm talking about somebody in-house that would alleviate us of having to kind of do this.
Oh, we could never, if the Department of Revenue is requesting an appraisal, an assessor can't complete that appraisal.
No, that's what I'm asking. Can we bring someone on that's qualified to do these things? If someone has this certification that they're requesting of us to get, why can't we do that for that $5,000?
Because they want an outside firm to complete it.
But didn't he say it's a... Wait, what part of that is a recommendation and not a requirement then?
It's a recommendation that we complete these two appraisals on the mall and the hospital.
Okay, I don't know if I want to ask it again, but I don't think I understand. So if we could have someone in-house do this.
We can't have someone in-house do it.
Just based solely on the fact that no one has the...
No, it's not.
Qualification?
When communities get a... When Stewart went public, mm-hmm. we had to hire an outside company to come in and do it. That's how that's their requirement.
Okay, I thought you said it was just a recommendation.
It is a recommendation, but I answered the Department of Revenue. During our certification process, you try to make them happy. It's a good recommendation to see if I make sure our values are fair and equitable.
No, I understand that. I don't know if I'm asking it clearly. I understand that. I just don't understand why we cannot have someone that from this firm be in our employ that can do these same things. Is it just the certification that we're lacking from this person? Or is it in the guideline or something from DOR that says the municipality cannot perform this particular service? You must get outside counsel or outside
What concept. They're asking for is an appraisal, not an assessment.
Just a point of information, Mr. Chairman.
Counselor?
Am I correct to the chair that the reason we don't have a commercial appraiser is that that's the mayor's call, who he appoints to the Board of Assessors. Am I correct?
My belief is we don't have one because we don't do appraisals very often. We do assessments.
Okay.
So my understanding in the past, and I'm talking as a point of information, is that it would be financially foolish to pay to have a commercial appraiser on staff, which my guess would make $150,000 a year or $200,000 a year, as opposed to an assessor, where we deal with that every day. I think, Mr. Condon, is that a pretty safe? In other words, point of information is we don't do commercial appraisals in the city enough that it would be cost effective to have commercial appraisers on staff, which are a specialty, much like a lawyer, and we would be paying somebody a very high price for something that we don't do very often.
Yeah, I know. And well, that kind of leads me to the next question. So how often are these kind of appraisals recommended or required? Is it every couple of years? Is it quarterly?
This is the first time since I've been here. This is the first time in the 3 years I've been here.
But it's going to come up again, though, right?
Not necessarily, because they're always going to be the top two taxpayers in the city.
Well, because, I mean, if I go by what Councilor Farrell said about 2 years ago, these two particular properties that are in question were appraised at a certain amount or whatever, and we're back here 2 years now. That's $100,000, right?
Stewart was appraised when they became a public from nonprofit.
Just a point of information, the hospital was a nonprofit, did not pay taxes.
Oh, that's right, at the time.
Went private, yes. The city came up with an appraised number, they sued in court sued in court to argue that, which I believe the city knew that would happen. And basically, I don't want to say too much, the courts decided what the valuation was on it was a settlement in court. So,
All right, so bottom line is just not cost effective to have someone to be able to do this instead of having to go out.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. I'll reserve my further questions. Thank you.
Anybody else?
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a favorable recommendation back to full council.
Second. Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably back to the full city council. All those in favor Opposed? Recommended favorably. Item number 9.
Order appropriation of $20,000 from unappropriated estimated receipts of the general fund for fiscal 2017 to finance department personal service other than part-time. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Conan, Chief Financial Officer.
All right, let's hope this is an easy one. What do you got?
Okay, I've got a vacant position in my office because Mel has been promoted to city auditor. So I'd like to fill that position. In addition to that, I'd like to hire a position financial analyst, which is an ordinance title. And the purpose of that position would be to provide basically full financial analysts, but especially to look at the public safety budgets every year as they're developed and as they're expended. There's a lot of money. You can see from the discussion that comes before the city council every year, especially with respect to overtime. I think it would be helpful to have somebody in the office, in my office, who could help both chiefs and give us an independent assessment of it. So the $20,000 is basically to hire both titles. I'd like to hire the budget director at the second step, because the first step of the budget director and the first step of the financial analyst is about the same, and one will be above the other. And there's enough money going to be left in the budget because of Mel's departure with the vacancy that exists there. The $20,000 this year should accomplish. Hopefully that goes through.
Point of information, that person would have been able to tell us where the overtime money has been spent.
I would hope that one of the problems that, with respect to the issue that Councilor Farwell raised is in the police budget especially. There are so many different overtime accounts, and their time and attendance system is so complicated that we don't account in our budget for overtime by person or by rank. We account for it in total. The payroll system does that, and it's a question of pulling those two systems together. So to be better informed on that, we need the analyst, but we also need to replace that old time and attendance system that we're using in the police department, and we've got a project to do that. So that's one of the problems that's confronting Councilor Farwell.
Well, just as a point of information, Mr. Conant, they already have an overtime court time software program. So if you can only give us overtime court time by rank, you know, let's compromise. That will at least break it down. How many captains had court time overtime? How many lieutenants? Because we just would like to know.
No, I understand what your request is. I do understand that. But what I'm saying is in the Munis system, that isn't how the
right.
appropriation is tracked.
Right.
It takes merging the data from two different systems to do it. But the point really is, if we have this position in my office, we would be in a better position to assist in that and have that information.
I agree.
Questions? Councilor Sullivan.
Mr. Conan, I like the idea of a financial analyst. I think it makes sense. And if you could, Mr. Chair, I'm just going to go off track for 1 second. I've talked about this I've been on the council 11 years. City of Quincy City Council has legislative council like we do here in the city of Brockton, Attorney Gilday. They also have vis-a-vis ordinance, a financial analyst for the city council that helps the council during the budget. It's a little off track here, but I think it somewhat talks about your financial analyst position you're looking for. What would your opinion be relative to a financial analyst to assist the council during the budget?
I think it's kind of comparable to the commercial appraiser, whether there's a sufficient amount of work year in, year out, to make it really worthwhile. But I wouldn't oppose it, Counselor. I'm not sure. Maybe you have a heavy investment at certain times of the year, not full time.
Not all time.
But
okay.
Maybe there's a way we could provide the assistance. And if you're thinking you need it independent of my office, then that's another matter, too. We could talk about that.
Thank you, Mr. Conn. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Motion?
Motion to recommend favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably. Full City Council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably.
Thank you.
Counselor. Item number 10.
Order appropriation of a grant award in the amount of $7,781.52 from the Massachusetts Department of Public Health Region Number 5 Massachusetts Association of Health Boards grant to the City of Brockton Board of Health Massachusetts Association of Health Boards grant fund. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Louis Taglia, Board of Health Director.
I was looking around to see.
I did receive information from Mr. Taglia, unable to be here tonight. Counselor?
I think I can make this easy. I got a call from Mr. Tartaglia. He had a family emergency. He will not be here. He has the check in hand already. There is nothing that the city has to put in.
Right.
It's a straight up grant. I would make a motion that this go favorably to the city council.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Recommend favorably full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. Item number 11.
Order.
We're flying now.
Order appropriation of $102,000 from the unappropriated estimated receipts of the general fund for fiscal year 2017 to stabilization fund. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Martin Brophy, Treasurer, Tax Collector.
Okay.
Mr. Condon.
Okay, councilors, there are two appropriation requests to the stabilization fund, and we did that in order to make a little bit easier decision for you, perhaps. The first of these is basically a balancing amount of the budget that was submitted to you back in June, and the changes that have occurred, including growth in the tax rate, cherry sheet, other appropriations that you've made. This would, aside from the $350,000 you postponed, this would make the budget balanced as submitted. So that's what the $102,000 is. There's another one later, which is a little bit different, but that's what this one is. If you remember, when the mayor submitted his budget, he did not fully appropriate the levy increase under Prop 2.5 that he was allowed to use, nor did he appropriate the levy capacity that had existed from a couple of years ago. This $102,000 does not touch any of that. It's just budget as submitted to you, taking care of changes and a little bit of extra money.
Councilor Sullivan.
Mr. Conan, how much as of today is in the stabilization?
I think about $5.3 million, roughly about
$5.3. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. Condon. So if we were to use, or still the 2.5 levy money, is that still available to us, or do we have to wait?
Well, there's no, you don't have to wait. We're trying to take care of all of it. The next item appropriates the fiscal 17 2.5 growth to its full amount, but that's not what we're talking about right now. With this appropriation, notwithstanding the $350,000 that was postponed a few minutes ago,
right.
The budget that was submitted to you in June is balanced, net of all of the changes that have occurred since then, still leaving $600,000+ of 2.5 levy money that could have been used from fiscal 17's 2.5 growth unused.
Okay.
If that helps.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Motion for favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. Full City Council.
Thank you.
Item number 12.
Order appropriation of $635,000 from the unappropriated estimated receipts of the general fund for fiscal year 2017 to the stabilization fund. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Martin Brophy, Treasurer, Tax Collector.
Move favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably.
Thank you, Congressman.
By the way, just to let everybody know, Mr. Brophy, thanks for being here tonight. Item 13.
Order appropriation of $50,000 from unappropriated estimated receipts to the general fund for fiscal year 2017 to public property capital elevator repair. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, James Casseri, Superintendent of Buildings.
Motion for favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to full City Council.
On the motion.
On the motion, Councilor Razak, I believe, was first.
Councilor
Rodriguez.
I just have a quick question. You didn't even give the guy a chance to explain what he was going to do.
That's fine with me, Counselor.
That was the plan.
Now, we've gone through this, fixing this elevator now for quite some time. What is it going to take to replace that elevator?
That's what this is, Counselor. If you recall, I put in for the budget $115,000 to repair the elevator. It's in my budget right now. And when I had the engineers evaluate the elevator, they told me that the repairs that are required to make the elevator what you're asking it to be would require $50,000 more than I have. So in order for me to put it out to bid, I need $165,000. That would allow me $15,000 contingency money and $150,000. And the elevator will be down by contract no more than 3 weeks.
Now, see, you can blame this, my question to Councilor Monahan, because if he had let you answer the question, well, I wouldn't be asking the question.
Right.
Thank you, Mr. Thank you, Mr. Casseri.
Yep.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Anybody else? Councilor Sullivan.
I have a question. If it's going to be out of order for 3 weeks, what's the contingency for residents coming here that need the elevator?
Yeah, we're going to have a plan. I'll probably set up an area in the basement where if someone comes in and they're not able to make it to whatever floor they want to go to, we'll have a clerk or whoever they're seeking from whatever department come down, and we'll have to wait on them there.
Okay.
We're going to have some kind of plan on that.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Motion made and seconded to recommend to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably.
Thank you.
Thank you. Item 14.
Order appropriation of $73,037.87 from unappropriated estimated receipts of the general fund for fiscal year 2017, $73,037.87, to fiscal year 2016 court judgments of $62,904.30, roof repair fund 4309 for $632.46, fiscal year 2015 9/11 grant fund 3306 for $3,381.43, in fiscal year 2013 911 grant fund 3278 in the amount of $6,119.68. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer.
Okay, councilors, in order to set the tax rate, if there are any deficits out there, the city has to eliminate the deficits. Court judgments is an account that's allowed to be overspent or deficit spent. This basically closes out fiscal 16 spending. The other three are state grant funds, and sometimes those are reimbursement funds. Sometimes the state will disallow a reimbursement request. We'll chase and chase and chase. If we're not going to get it, we finally say, let's give up the ghost on this and close out the deficit, and that's what those three are.
Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Conan, relative to the court judgments, like snow and ice, you can deficit spend, but you have to pay it back next year. Is court judgments the same type of caveats?
Yes.
And you forecast we'd be able to do that going forward?
Yes, and this will actually put fiscal 16's budget with the deficit that was in there to bed. So it's gone.
Okay.
It's gone with this appropriation.
Okay.
And great. Now we're in this year, so we're good.
Good to go. Okay. Good to go. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Favorable recommendation back to full council.
Second.
On the motion.
On the motion, Councilor Barnes.
Thank you. So in the budget, I'm just looking. There were two line items for court judgment.
Yep.
And this actually, there were three.
Yep.
So there's a lot of money here. It's like.
Well, basically what happened was when we submitted the budget, there was an account deficit in the court judgments line, and the appropriations that you're looking for, I think they came from the overlay reserve lines, eliminated the deficit as we knew it to exist when we submitted the budget. Since then, another judgment came in that the city had to pay, and this takes care of that.
Okay, wait, say that last thing one more time, I'm sorry. Just that last sentence one more
well,
time.
Well, we submitted the budget sometime in May.
Yes.
Fiscal year didn't end until June 30.
Yes.
We cleared what we thought were the deficits that existed, and there was an additional judgment that had to be paid, and this amount wasn't satisfied by the appropriations in the budget. This takes care of it.
I see. Okay. And roof repair, what was that for?
Well, there was a school roof project, a bunch of them, several projects, and they are projects where the city spends the money, mm-hmm. submits it to the state to get reimbursed. Sometimes they disallow expenses.
Okay, all right, I just want to be clear. And the grant funds, is this for unexpected matching? Because
No, it's not for unexpected matching. Again, these are 911 training funds, and there were some costs that we had submitted reimbursement for those 2 years that they didn't allow.
Okay.
We tried to get it pushed, and they weren't about to do it, so we're closing it up.
Okay. All right, great. Thank you, Mr. Condon. Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Chairman.
You. Council Beauregard.
Oh, I'm all set.
Well, you're all set. Council Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Condon, just a quick question. Is there any way I could get a list of, let's say, the last 2 years' worth of judgments that the city actually was involved in? And for myself or any other council that might want to see this? Because I'm not exactly sure where even to look to see, you know, basically these lawsuits that the city is settling with outside plaintiffs, in a sense. Could we get that list?
I can get you a list, I think, of the amounts that were spent. I'm not certain if I can get you a list of the actual cases that they represented, but I can get you a list of the...
But like the name of the entity and the amount?
I'll have to talk to the solicitor about that. But in terms of the amounts, I can get, yes.
Okay.
If there's no objection, Mr. Nizzarello, can you step forward and answer us on that?
Basically, the last 2 years, just to get an idea what the number of judgments against the city that have been settled, just the name of the entity and the amount of money that actually was.
Put together judgments and settlements, which are two separate things.
Both.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Both. So that we have an idea exactly what's going on with the city funds. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Anyone else? I believe we had a motion already, didn't we?
Yes.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably to full city council. Item number 15.
Order appropriation of $70,000 from unappropriated estimated receipts to the general fund for fiscal year 2017 to the fire department personal services overtime in order to provide added funding for overtime such as hazardous material, team response and training, 911 emergency dispatch training, and training for the Plymouth County Technical Response Team. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Conan, Chief Financial Officer, Michael Williams, Fire Chief.
Okay, councilors, every year we have revolving funds that are authorized by the City Council. This last year, this particular revolving fund wasn't submitted for reauthorization. By the time Chief Williams realized it, my office realized it, we're now into the fall. So he needs to have his overtime account replenished because the revolving fund has been closed and we can't reestablish it for this year. So what this does is it makes certain he's got enough money to pay out of his budget what would have been paid out of the revolving fund, and we'll reauthorize the revolving fund next year. The reimbursements that this is usually funded by will simply flow to the general fund this year.
Okay. Councilors?
Move favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you, Chief.
Item 16.
Resolve that the City Council authorize the approval of the proposed Housing Development Incentive Program HDIP tax increment exemption agreement tie for 93 Center Street between the City and Yomar Realty Trust. Invited Rob May, Director of Planning.
Good evening, Mr. May.
Good evening, sir. I would like to point out that this and the next item are related to each other and that they're both on the same subject matter, just two different applicants. The Housing Development Investment Program is a state initiative to create market rate housing in gateway communities. And last year, City Council passed the creation of the Housing Development District in our downtown area. We have our first two applications who are coming forward to us. There's a two-level incentive. The first is a state tax credit for the market rate housing. The second is a local exemption from of a percentage of the incremental increase in value that we have on the specific properties. In your packet, there should be two spreadsheets. And if you don't have them, I have extra copies. Sounds like we don't.
I believe it's the last page of the information that's...
There's one, though.
Yeah, well, there's one for each. One for the 90.
Yeah, the last page.
The 7.
There's one for 47 Pleasant, and there should be a second one.
We're only talking 93 Center Street right now.
Or 93 Center Street, excuse me.
They're different packets and they're different agenda items.
Different
so
staples.
I have it here, I'm sorry.
We need to stick to, I believe you have the one, 93 Center Street in front of you, councilors.
Yep. I got it. Yep.
I don't know what I need.
Just so you know, we're on one. We're on 93 Center Street.
We're on that. So if I could call your attention to the last two columns, I think those are the most important. In 93 Center Street, the furniture building, the applicant is going to be investing about $13 million in the project. The second to last column is the estimated taxes that the applicant will be paying to the city. The last column is an estimate on the percentage of exemption that they're looking for.
Yeah.
And in this case, we're looking at a 20% exemption on the increment for 5 years? 6 years, excuse me. And a 10% on the remaining 5 years. So for a total value, exemption over an 11-year period. So with that, over that period, the Total estimated taxes coming to the city of Brockton are $583,149. The estimated value of the total exemption or our incentive part of the program is $86,851.
Point of information, the column that says estimated exemption, $200,605, is that value? Expected value on the building? Or?
That is the expected, the estimated exemption. So if you take the base tax, add the incremental, estimated increment, the estimated increment times the percentage rate, there are the amount of the exemption, is the estimated exemption. So if you take the base plus the estimated increment minus the exemption equals the new residential value.
You ready?
Mr. May, can you repeat that one more time?
Okay. The estimated exemption is the estimated increment times the estimated exemption rate. So in the first line where we have numbers, there's $1 million at 20%. So the estimated exemption is $200,000. If you take the base, which is $8,164, plus the $1 million minus the estimated increment exemption of the $200,000 equals the value of $1.270,270. So we will be getting an additional amount of funds. Our total estimated taxes for that year will be $22,000, which is an increase over the existing $8,000 that's being paid. The amount of the exemption is valued at $3,472. So that's our incentive to the developer to build market rate housing or to make that $13 million investment. So for a total of $86,851, the developer is going to invest $13 million into Brockton, on which he will pay taxes of $583,149,000.
Council Beauregard.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I believe I spoke to you earlier. I would like to have more information before we have a decision on this, if it would be possible to postpone this. I'd like to know more about the company that wants to invest, what it would look like, and how it would enhance the area. I mean, I'm familiar with the building.
Councilor, I have the applicant right here this evening.
And he does have all the information that we could see what everything would look like.
Yes, and you were at the press launch that we had at
the gallery
at Enzo Flats.
Oh,
where,
yes. But
where
that
he showed
was...
that is the project that we're discussing.
No, I realize, but that was a little bit limited in scope. It didn't have all the details. For example, as item number 17 that we are much more familiar with, and that's what I'd like to know more about. Thank you.
With pleasure, Mr. Carmen is here, if you don't mind.
And I'm sorry, what's this gentleman's name?
Ted Carmen from Concord Square Development.
Okay. If there's no objections, he's not an invited guest, but if there's no objections,
okay,
if you could show us what you can.
Sure. My name is Ted Carmen. I'm president of Concord Square Planning and Development from Boston, and I am a joint venture partner with John Monum, who owns the building, and we are developing it together. The plan for the building is to have 51 apartments, seven apartments on each of the 7 upper floors and 2 apartments on the first floor. Half of the first floor, the front half facing Montello Street, will be commercial. I've got some, we're doing the project using state and federal historic tax credits, which require us to restore the exterior of the building to its original condition and require us to maintain most of the existing detail on the inside of the building, particularly having to do with the stairways, stairwells, and so forth. So we will be building apartments on each floor. The outside of the building will have all new windows, all new heating systems, all new, actually the sprinkler system is up and operable at this point, but all of the utilities will be rebuilt. There will be in the basement a community room and also an exercise facility. It will be, the zoning for the area is under Chapter 40R, which requires 20% of the units to be affordable at 80% of median, and the other 80% will be market rate, which means that they don't have limitations on the rents. We'll charge the rents that the market will bear. We will have approximately, we've requested in our zoning request to have approximately 58 parking spaces, which is 1 for each apartment plus 6 for the commercial space. And we are hoping to have to work out a swap on the parking. Currently, W.B. Mason has the right to use the on-grade parking on Railroad Street, and we would like, and we have talked with the parking authority about having them move into the new parking garage that the state just announced funding for a couple of weeks ago, and then much of our parking would be on Railroad Street, and 5 or 6 spaces would be on Church Street. We're going to the Traffic Commission later this month to work out the details of how that would all work. I've got plans here, including a plan showing the new exterior of the building, which, as I said, is going to be renovated so it's historically accurate. The windows will be beautiful. They'll be brand new. They will have double panes, be energy efficient. The building itself will be very energy efficient when we get done.
Council Borghardt, you still have the floor?
Yeah, yes, thank you. No reflection on you, Mr. Carmen. I'm sorry. We have to be a little bit concerned about this whole situation, of course. I realize with the requirements, because we are concerned, we want more market rate housing downtown. And also, since we've had, how would I say it, not a complete experience with the Trinity Financial across the street, where we were supposed to see a restaurant, and we were told at a recent meeting it might be another 2 years before that restaurant comes to that commercial space. That was a little frustrating. And we also, with the parking garage, yes, in one respect that was exciting to see some money come in, but then I have been to tech review, and I've also been to planning, where they've told us that they're probably 1 to 2 years behind in their finance. And I guess this is why we are concerned. It sounds great. We want to see this attractive, this building certainly upgraded and attractive. We want the foot traffic. We want to see commercial businesses downtown that bring revenue to our city that look attractive. And we're a little concerned because, I would say, the track record across the street hasn't been what we were hoping. And how would I say it? I'm not sure where to go because...
Counselor, you know, for the record, the 40R project that is Trinity is the residential section. It has nothing to do with the Enterprise Center, which is the office development.
Okay.
So, when people say 40R is a failure, that is just not true. It built a high quality product that is was leased up before it was officially occupied. There are a few apartments that over the year have become available as people have moved out for various reasons. There is a long waiting list, at least a three-year waiting list, that's been capped at the moment. So I would say it's been a spectacular success. Now, we know that there are some issues with the office space and with the restaurant space. That does take time. We do not have the population downtown to support a restaurant, and that's why we need additional housing projects like 93 Center Street, like Phase 2 of Trinity, like 47 Pleasant Street, and any other projects that we're going to be bringing forward.
I understand your point, you know, that you're separating the Trinity financial part. Does Mr. Carman see how long this will take, and is there already, how would I say, plans to post availability for these apartments and for the commercial space? Because to me, I would include the commercial space within that building as part of his project.
In this case, it is part of his project. How long it takes for him to lease that up, I would discuss that with Mr. Carman, but in the real estate market, first floor retail is usually a net zero. The project is being financed on its ability to lease the residential space. The market, the banks, the lending institutions know that it's difficult to lease retail space, but he is certainly going to be working very hard to fill that. Anything that comes in off of that is going to be a definite positive for him. And it's also going to drive residential development above him, or the residential leases above him.
Thank you.
All set.
Put up to my colleagues.
Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Carman, good evening. How are you? I just had two quick questions for you. Thanks for being here tonight.
You bet.
Relative to the historic tax credits, it's going to be a portion of your funding.
Yes.
To my knowledge, there's only been two developers in the city of Brockton thus far that have utilized that. Brophy Phillips, Commercial Street, which is across from the Rocky Marciano Post Office, worked great. And then Jason Korb, the old Stalin D building on Montello Street, it worked well.
W.B. Mason got them as well.
Oh, well, Mason got a historic tax credit?
Yes. And so did Jason Korb.
I just said Jason Korb.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Yes, right.
Mr. Carman,
well,
there are two types of
tax credits. You're aware, the federal credits and the state credits.
Yeah, no, I'm very familiar with them.
Yes.
Yeah,
okay.
I'm a real estate attorney. I know it very well. My question is, in terms of the funding rounds and the application process, what's your timing on that, number one? And number two, another major concern that I have would be your backup plan if the parking endeavors you're talking about don't come to fruition. If W.B. Mason does not agree to do that, what's your backup?
We have an agreement with BAT to have parking in their garage, which would be less attractive to us, but would work. They've given us a letter saying we can lease up to 35 spaces from them indefinitely.
And then in terms of the funding round for...
We've made, as you're aware, it's very difficult getting the state historic tax credits.
Yep.
We applied last January. We got turned down. And they had problems with our plans. We fixed the plans, resubmitted in April, got turned down again, more problems with the plans. And the federal response to the plans had a list of things we needed to fix.
Okay.
We resubmitted at the end of August. We're waiting to hear about that.
Okay.
The reason for that it would be helpful to move this forward soon is that the HDIP program has a 25% tax credit. There's some competition for that money. We can't really apply for the money until we have this tax agreement in hand and the zoning in hand. There's also a new program called the Workforce Housing Trust Fund that was just legislated in the economic development bill that was signed by the governor on August 10th. And it provides for the HDIP, it provides for support to projects up to twice the amount of the HDIP credit for certain projects. And that is something that we hope to get in line for as well, which would mean we don't have to wait for the state historic tax credits. We could move forward much more rapidly.
Okay.
So we're trying to move this forward in a responsible and hopefully aggressive way to get the zoning done, to get this tax agreement done, then we can apply to the state for the HDIP funding, and we can see if we can put together this Workforce Housing Trust Fund money, which we hopefully can do early next year.
Next year?
Right.
Okay.
So it's not going to happen overnight.
Right.
For sure.
Never does. Yeah, never does. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And the other point I'd like to emphasize about the HDIP program is that the maximum amount of subsidy of affordable units that you can have is 20%. The zoning requires us to have 20%, but it's only at 80% of median. When I say only, it's because rents at 80% of median are essentially market rents in Brockton. In other words, 80% rents are close to $1,200, or $1,200 for a one-bedroom and $1,400 for a two-bedroom. So our affordable housing units will rent for $1,200 for the one-bedrooms and $1,400 for the two-bedrooms, and the market rate rents probably will not rent for a whole lot more than that. So I think the HDIP program is very clear about requiring market rate housing, not affordable housing. We're not in line. We're not planning to use the low-income housing tax credits at all for this. So I think you can rest assured on that. And also the Workforce Housing Trust Fund, which we're hoping to get financing under, has no requirements for affordable housing. And in fact, you only get the money on the market rate units, the subsidy money. So there are real incentives in the financing to have market rate units.
Thank you, Councilor Sullivan. Anyone else?
Make a motion for favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor?
On the motion.
On the motion.
Through you, Mr. Chair. Councilor, are you satisfied with that? I know earlier you wanted to postpone. Are you satisfied with
what? I am, again, I'm concerned because, you know, these two turned down for financially. I suppose at this point it's best to move it forward towards city council, and we'll continue maybe having them come up in front of us to keep us posted.
Thank you, Council. Thank you, Chairman.
Council, motion made and seconded to recommend. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably to full City Council. Item number 17.
Resolve that the City Council authorize the approval of their proposed Housing Development Incentive Program HDIP Tax Increment Exemption Agreement for 47 Pleasant Street between the City and 47 Pleasant Street Realty Trust. Invited Rob May, Director of Planning.
Good evening. I hope I'll do a better job of explaining it, this one. 47 Pleasant Street has received its zoning permissions and is now in the financing stage as they apply for their tax credits with the state for market rate housing. They're looking at, to the city to tighten up and finalize their local incentive. So in this case, the developer is going to spend $2.5 million renovating the old standard modern printing and creating housing units there. This will be 100% market rate. Over the years that he is requesting an exemption, which ranges from 30 to 25 and then finally ends up at 20% over the time period, he will pay $208,000 in taxes, of which the incentive portion is about $47,285. Again, if he does not build, he does not get a exemption. And we're back with the original base value of the building, which is paying approximately $9,622 a year of base rent, or base tax, excuse me. Tired.
Councilor Burns.
Thank you. I just had a question, and I don't even know if it's fair to really compare the two, but why are the years different for 47 than 93? It's like less 5 years.
Each deal requires a different amount of capital to make work.
Oh, okay.
And in some cases, a developer may need more incentive from the city, especially if you're building more units. There's more of a gap, financial gap. In this case, there's a much smaller gap that needs to be filled. And so we're trying to cram it down as little as possible.
That's fair. Okay, thank you.
Councilor Azak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. May, do we have an idea? I wasn't at. I think this person presented themselves for planning or zoning. I'm not sure.
At the zoning board, and there's a lot of discussion.
How many units are we looking at?
Joffrey, what is your last name? Sorry, I'm just blanking.
Anatole.
The developer, Joffrey Anatole. Joffrey Anatole is here. He has not been invited, but...
if there's no objection, we'll let him speak.
No, thank you.
Yeah, he could.
So it's going to be 24 market rate units. 14 of them are going to be 2 bedrooms. 10 of them are going to be 1 bedrooms.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, could you say that again, please?
24 units total. 14 of them are going to be 2 bedrooms. 10 of them are going to be 1 bedrooms. Just to give you guys a little more clarification about the program, the reason I'm here now and not earlier is because we just got approval for the project on October 12th. Preliminary certification, which is the first part of the HDIP, essentially certification process, requires that we have a tax agreement with the city that's already been fully executed. We can't even submit the documents for approval until the city essentially approves this agreement. At this point with our project, we're looking to start April of 2016. Every single thing that probably should have not come to fruition at this point has come to fruition. This is the only thing that could possibly hold the project up. And again, given the time frames we have, it's not going to. But essentially, once we have approval, we can submit part one of the application. DCHD will turn it back around to us in about a week. We'll submit part two. And again, everything else is already in order to start in April of 2017. We've already been in front of the zoning board. I've tried to keep most of the counselors up to date as much as possible regarding even this. And again, even since the October 12th, zoning board hearing, we've made, again, a lot of improvements. And, you know, it's a project that's going to be what everyone expects it to be. So, I mean, I'd be glad to answer any, you know, questions that anyone has regarding the project or how this, you know, program impacts it or anything in between.
Excuse me. Approximately how much will you be looking for rent for, like, a two-bedroom?
Two bedrooms? So, right now, good question. I'm conservative by nature. But, you know, again, you have to take into account we're starting construction in April of 2017. So we're going to start marketing for occupancy April of 2018. Based on figures we have right now, we have a range of, you know, $1,350 to $1,500. Again, I say $1,350 to $1,500 because by nature I'm going to be conservative. I don't want to tell you guys $1,500 and then it'd be potentially $1,350. But, you know, realistically, that's, you know, what the ranges are. Even right now, station lofts are renting 2 bedrooms for $1,495. No utilities included. That doesn't include water. Enterprise building is around $1,450. The development by Brophy and Phillips, I know they were mentioned earlier, on Oak Street is renting for $1,480 to $1,550. I was there a few weeks ago. So these are, the rents that I'm paying are really conservative, and they're based on today's market, not even a year and a half in the future when, you know, they'll be occupied. But let me assure you this. I'm going to start high, of course. I'm not going to, you know, at the lowest rent. We're going to try to, you know, get the highest that the market will allow. And like I said, it's going to be a, you know, bring in people with, you know, income to essentially spend money.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor.
Make a favorable recommendation back to full council.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Item number 8. No, I think we've already done 18.
Yes, we have.
Yes. Item 19.
Resolved to invite Sergeant Brenda Perez and their recently hired crime analyst to present their findings and progress on the study that began in April 2016 for the city of Brockton. Invited Sergeant Brenda Perez, Hillary Thompson, crime analyst.
Councilors, Lieutenant Hallisey, I believe he called today, is going to be making the presentation. I'm not sure why, but he can fill us in.
Yes, I passed out these pamphlets there. I'll just give you a brief history of the crime analyst. In April, we hired a Hillary Thompson to be our crime analyst. We had none before. They started this from scratch with Brenda Perez, who was a sergeant. And they worked on this, and this is what we came up with, our current crime analysis.
Councilor Beauregard, anything you want to say before he starts his presentation?
It's not really a presentation, it's just what we're doing.
Well, as the clerk just read, that we were looking for various information, and what happened here is Captain Hallisey called me earlier today, said he would be coming in place.
Sorry about that.
I'm sorry?
Sorry about that. I demoted you.
Oh.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. And Hillary Thompson is a new crime analyst for the city, and she reports to Sergeant Brenda Perez, and in turn reports to Captain Hallisey here. So what we have inside here is what I wanted Captain Hallisey to go through briefly, and the idea was to begin to inform the public of what has transpired with this crime analyst, what they've discovered, what plans they have, what progress they've made, and to in the future, near future, make plans to have a public, what do we discuss today? Community policing forum, where the public would have an opportunity to ask more questions and receive more information on this. So I'll pass it back to Captain Hallisey. Thank you.
Yeah, in here we got a sample of bulletins, reports, you know, it includes like the analysis and facilitating information. Each item in the folder has a brief description of what the product is. Like the first one here, if you look at it, it's the Daily Intelligence Bulletin. What we have here is we have the robberies, the drug incidents. We give these to the offices. Also, it's on the email, and it's more specific information. This has all been redacted, a lot of the information about the names and stuff that we can give out. They get a brief synopsis of what happened, assault, domestic violence, the shot spotters, people that were arrested. It's just more information for the officers on the street. A lot of the times each shift has it's a different entity in itself. We can share more information this way. They also have certain incidents. It's sort of like a roll call, but this goes throughout the whole day. It's easier to get the information. That's pretty much what our daily intelligence bulletin is. It's a lot to absorb at first, but it's what we got there, what they do. Also, you ask for like analysis, collaborated efforts. We work with the Boston, Cambridge, Quincy. We work with several departments. They go to seminars. She goes to a monthly meeting to get more information out. And through these collaboration efforts, some of them come to like West Bridgewater Police. They assist in identifying a suspect involved in multiple B&Es. So we work with other places that we wouldn't usually get this kind of information.
Did it include that in there?
You go to the next page. This is the regional meetings they go. They meet at certain places, the Southeastern Mass Intelligence Group, the Plymouth County District Attorney's Office, for the monthly street violation suppressing work group. And then this third page is following. I'm going quick, but the crime analyst, the bulletins for the police consumption, active warrants, wanted posters, your situational awareness information bulletins, BOLOs, a lot of things for officers' safety. They get emailed on their phones, find out what's going on for certain things that come up, certain hides they have in cars, anything that's for officers' safety. They also have a bulletin with pictures that we have. If you look at the next page for active warrants, they have the name, the addresses. We have that. But this is the redacted version. There's a police bulletin for someone wanted. If you're in the right place at the right time, you got that information. Also, new things that come up. If you look at the other page, that creating powder, whatever, that's stuff that's out there, the new stuff that a lot of guys don't see unless you go to these drug seminars, any new information that we can get out. The BOLOs, certain thefts that are coming up. For this one, there was tire rims stolen, you know, from 64 Westland Street over the overnight hours. The midnight shift will get that. We'll give it to the other shifts. That way, at least some guys work, when you work a 4-2, sometimes you're not on the day certain things happen. So we can get that information out. There's some more officer safety stuff. Also, another thing we use with the crime analyst for the mapping and the shots fired. Gives you some information there about what's going on, some crime mapping that they developed. It's in the computers. And we have the overdose report for some of the overdoses happening, some new stuff that's out there. Some new drugs that are coming up. So it just gives guys more information on what's going on. It's easier to share through this stuff. I don't know if you have any questions.
Well,
it's a lot to absorb, I know.
Oh, no, I realize. And two things. Well, first of all, we had mentioned, and we'll work that out another time, when we can have a more of a public meeting, like you mentioned, with community policing, to let the public know. But I'm curious, I mean, wouldn't it be possible to put this report, online somewhat? We could have a link so that the citizens of the city could see, you know, what's transpiring.
Some of the stuff was ongoing investigations. We got to be careful of.
Oh no, I realize that some of it's confidential.
And a lot of the stuff has to be redacted, and we can't put a lot of the stuff out there online. But what we can show, it's fine.
Yeah. So, because that would be positive that certain and your emphasis on working collaboratively and communicating more with other law enforcement, other situations, and you had and I had heard having spoken to both Hillary and Brenda, she had been out walking. Hillary had walked the streets in the local area to see and observe what was transpiring.
Yeah, she's done a ride along. The detectives, we've got her out there doing just to get a look at it, to do stuff.
And that's what we wanted, to have her learn about her input and how we can better serve the community so everyone, feels safer. And this helps both residents and businesses. So that was my goal here, and I was hoping that meanwhile, I believe, and again, I don't expect you to answer this part, it seems that the more we compile information, work closely with other agencies to try to improve the safety of this community, it would seem that would open us more to grants and other opportunities.
Yeah, that's what we're hoping. It's just started. We've only been here like 7 months, but we're hoping
it
gets bigger and bigger.
Okay. Thank you very much, Captain Harrison.
Thank you, Councilor.
And I'll defer to my colleagues.
Councilor Razak.
Thank you. Good evening, Captain.
How are you doing?
Are we doing more police reports now that we do have an analyst? I don't know if
the reports are the same, but we're getting information out to everybody.
Okay.
Like there's a big TV in the report room that goes. It's just the information's out there. It's like paramount that these guys, the more information you have, the easier it is to do your job.
Mm.
Like from the patrol to the supervisors to allocating manpower to helping the detectives out when they have something. Sometimes there's not a lot of communication going on. This forces us to get the information.
And that's, I'm not sure if I worded my question correctly. That's exactly what I'm hoping, is that we're getting the information to the different individuals that need to get the information. One of them.
It's there for them. And I mean, it just makes your job easier.
Now, as far as the residents, and I'm just going to use an example. A few years back, there was a minor break-in of a vehicle. Somebody broke the glass, took something not very important, but when the person called the police department, the operator just stated, if you'd like to, you can file a report. My opinion was we should have taken that report in case it could have been related to something else. And in this case, where we have an analyst, information
you're
like that's
right.
Important. You're
absolutely right. Any report, any information we have, whether they're not going to go through insurance or whatever, if we know where it's happening, we have it, the more information, the better.
So the operators working well with the new crime analyst to kind of...
Yeah, we want to know everything that's happening.
Very good, because I think that's my point, is sometimes the operators felt maybe if it wasn't something that was dire that, they...
The devil's in the details. We want to know. Yeah, we'll correct that problem.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you. Entertain a motion?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded to recommend favorably to full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably.
Thank you. Okay.
Number 20, if you could read it, please.
Resolve that the city's mayor and solicitor come before the finance committee to provide a status update and to discuss reacquiring the real property located at 226 Main Street, commonly known as the Ganley Building, that was conveyed by the city for nominal consideration to the Commonwealth for purposes of using the property as a college collaborative. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Philip Nazarella, City Solicitor.
Councilor Sullivan.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, Mr. Nazarella. Just a quick, any update on this?
Yeah, actually, I do have a report for you, Councilor. So, as we had discussed in one of the earlier meetings, that periodically from time to time I would come back to the committee to update you with the status of the building. So the timing this time around is actually pretty good because DCAM actually just internally had a meeting on the property last Friday. So there have been, I want to make sure I'm clear, that there has been an ongoing dialogue between our building department, Mr. Casseri, and DCAM on the building. So there has been regular communication, phone, et cetera. They have looked at the building twice now and are preparing to finalize a report. But I did call in and speak with someone there today with the intent to try to have something right up to the moment for you tonight. So they were able to give me a portion of the report. It's draft, it's not finalized. And what they're working on internally now, now that they've had a chance to look at the building, is for their engineers to decide what they think the best course of action for the building is. And essentially, they've identified three options. One would be to mothball the building, and they described that to me, is to restructure the integrity floor by floor to be able to reach the roof, that it might be more cost effective. They would have to reroute the gas line. I personally don't think that's very practical, and when you hear their report of the condition of the building, I think you'll agree. But mothballing is the first option, demolishing is the second option, and the third option would be to see if they can demo the building but somehow preserve the facade. I'm not so sure at this point that's practical either. However, for point of information, those are what they consider to be the three options of what they can do with the building. Now they're kind of meeting and crunching all the information they've gathered to try to come to a recommendation and then issue a report. But I'll share with you a portion of the draft that they're working with now that was just sent to me today. This is from the DCAM draft report regarding the Ganley building at 226 Main Street. Quote, please note that the please note that the abandoned building has suffered significant structural damage due to water infiltration through both the building envelope and due to a reported incident when the sprinklers were activated in the unoccupied building. This includes deteriorated wood flooring and joists, collapsed lathe and plaster ceilings, rusted structural and ornamental steel, peeling paint, buckled and moldy floor finishes, and mold and fungi throughout. The majority of the wood flooring throughout the building is buckled. The wood floor framing in many locations is moldy and rotted. Due to safety concerns, access was limited to view and document existing conditions. The capacity of the floor framing was questionable due to the water damage and concealment by the plaster ceilings. In other words, they don't feel safe to walk across the floor. And additionally, air quality within the building, and particularly the basement area, was poor due to the extensive mold growth throughout the building. So I think when you hear their own words in their draft version of the report, it paints a pretty bleak picture of the current condition of the building. Also in my conversations with them today, and I asked, gee, why are we even considering three options? Because, you know, I'm not an expert, but it, you know, I'm pretty sure that's a building that needs to be torn down. And he admitted that they're looking at cost, that one of the things they're required to look at is cost. When I had appeared in front of you earlier, Counselor, and I think Mr. Casseri, we had said we thought, or Mr. Casseri's thought was that the cost of a demo could be in the neighborhood of $400,000 to $500,000. DCAM is now saying it may be more like $700,000. It's expensive for many reasons, but the two primary reasons why it's such an expensive demo is as they tear this thing down, because of all the mold and all the asbestos, all of the rubble will be considered hot load. It will all have to require special handling and be disposed of as hazardous waste, which my understanding means putting it on a rail car and sending it out of state. That's expensive. And then the other thing is you've got to remember that this building is directly connected to buildings on each side of it. So they've got to take this down without damaging the good buildings that are on either side of it. And that also makes it a more expensive demo. So by no means am I an expert, but I do believe it is going to be a lot of money. I do believe it's going to have to come down, although they haven't officially concluded that yet. But I do think that with this update on the information that we are proceeding on the responsible course here, and that is to try to work with the state to get them to incur all of the expenses of taking this building down, most likely, so that we don't have to use taxpayer funds that we don't have in order to do it. Counselor, I'm in full agreement with you that once the building is down at the state's expense, then we will certainly have a very vigorous discussion with the state regarding the redevelopment of the property and whether they want to present a plan to us to see what we think, or if they don't have a plan, we'll ask for them to return the property to us so that we can oversee the redevelopment of the property. And that's where we're trying to get to, but I think that we have to, we've got to deal with this really dangerous building that's there right now. And I think that we have made a lot of progress with DCAM and getting them to move through the process. The state never moves fast at anything. But I think that it is moving along and quite a bit of progress is being made. And so our next step right now is to sit tight, wait for the final report to come out. We'll review that immediately. When I get it, I'll share it with the council. And then we'll see what our building department thinks of what their recommendations are. And, you know, it's hard to predict what our course of action would be until we actually get that final report. But I think that wording that they did send me today from the draft report is pretty telling about where we're going.
Absolutely, and I thank you for that update. And I guess my question would be, during your conversations, is there any thought, Mr. Mayor, that they're even going to give any consideration to your opinion or Jim Casseri's opinion on what you want to do? Or is because they're the owner of the building, those three options, they'll decide, and then we just have to live with it?
No, I think that their report's going to have a recommendation. But I think if we don't like it, we'll have an opportunity to continue the conversation with them and advocate when whatever form that might take, if that means us having to bring someone in to give us our own opinion, or I don't want to speculate about where it may go, because I'm hoping I like two out of the three options.
Yeah.
So, you know, so long as it's one of the two out of the three.
I love the facade, if they could keep
the facade. If it could be saved.
Yeah.
But, you know, honestly, when we were working with them with the school design, even though they wanted to keep the facade, they had said to us all along that was ideally what they'd like to do. But until they actually pulled it apart and saw what they had, they wouldn't know for sure. And that might turn out to be still the same thing.
Okay. Mr. Chair, I just had one question for the solicitor. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay.
Attorney Nezarelli, good evening.
Good evening.
Phil, the mayor just brought up the point about the buildings connected to existing structures that are sound and have thriving businesses in them. And since the owner is actually the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, so they would have to indemnify us for any type of damage done. Would it be your thoughts that the city of Brockton would be named as like an additional insured or something? Because my thought would be if any foundation unsettling or cracking or damage was done, I would hate for Brockton to get into a lawsuit that they really aren't a party to, since they don't own the property.
Oh, absolutely. That's, in fact, you hit it on the nail on the head. That is one of the elements that will be part of the dialogue with the state, that we are named additional insured so we don't have to undertake another process in the unfortunate event that something does go wrong.
Okay, so. Okay. I'm glad it's on your radar.
We need to protect the city in both of those adjoining properties.
Absolutely. Thank you, Attorney. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Burns.
Just really quickly, I'm not really sure. Maybe the mayor, actually, because you have the report. Just so that I'm clear, the actual building, for perspective, it doesn't include the storefronts downstairs, correct?
Oh, yes, it does. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, okay. So if that whole block would just be building, rubble, building? If it were to come down?
Right. It would turn into a vacant lot.
Okay.
And that's why I think that we would As we've discussed at previous meetings, the state can't do anything with it without us unless it's directly to benefit one of the educational institutions that's mentioned in the MOU. So unless they're going to build something for Bridgewater State, Massasoit, or UMass Boston, they can't do anything else with the property. But I think that we would certainly want to entertain any other ideas or proposals they might have for the redevelopment of the property before just, you know, demanding it back. And we've actually been doing some homework, and we're looking at, because this conversation also extends to the Christo site now. Once it's a vacant lot, we're talking about this property and the Christo's property. And we're actually looking at, in the town of North Reading, and getting documents where the state had property there, and they actually did enter into an agreement to turn it back over to the town for economic development purposes. And then the town put out an RFP to entertain proposals for the redevelopment, private redevelopment of the property. So there are a few different avenues we can go, but I think we've got to deal with the building first and then deal with the redevelopment of the property.
And then just one more thing.
I'm not crazy about a vacant lot, but I'm certainly not, I don't think we can just turn a blind eye to a deteriorating building there either.
I agree. I just so I'm clear. So the three options that you mentioned were, I guess, the preliminary proposal.
Mothball it, demo it, or demo it but keep the facade.
Right. So even it's, I don't even know if this is a premature question. So with the cost, even like you said, going up, you know, $300,000 from the original kind of estimate or our estimate, it going up, is there any indication or any possibility that the state might just say, just let's just not do anything to it, maybe let nature take its course, continue
no.
to take its course?
No, I
they will take action on it?
Yeah, we've okay. had numerous conversations have been going on. This I tried to mention at the beginning that there's been an ongoing dialogue between the building department and the state. My understanding of what makes this differently, because it's a state-owned building, our building commissioner does not have the right to just order it down like you would any other building. The law says that the state, their own engineers make the determination, they make the call. So that's what makes this situation a little more unique. Of course, they'll also be paying the bill, which is the part that we like, and why it makes sense to try to work with the state to have them take care of it. But no, these three options are what their three options are that they're looking at. And I just, when I read their description of mothballing, and then I listen to the description of how they describe the condition of the property, why would you put all that money into trying to shore something up that clearly is not going to be able to be saved later on? It just doesn't make any sense.
I understand. I just don't know if I trust that will be, that those will be our only options when the final report comes through.
Well, we'll find out. Concern. We're making progress. But this is how it was presented to me, that these are the three options that they're looking at.
Okay.
All set?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yes.
Councilor Sullivan.
Mr. Chairman, I want to make a motion to postpone this resolve. I'm going to make a motion to postpone to the, I'm going to say the second FinCom in February. And maybe by that time we even have some more of an update.
Second. Motion made second and postpone until the second FinCom in February. All those in favor? All those opposed? Postpone. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, councilors.
Thank
Item
you.
Item number 21.
Resolve that the mayor, police chief, fire chief, city solicitor, board of health director, and other relative city employees appear before the Finance Committee to discuss the recent actions taken by the city to vacate Tent City on privately owned property.
Chairman, waive the invited list.
Absolutely. You don't need to read the invited list. This is Councilor Sullivan.
Mr. Chairman, I'm gonna make a motion. I know all of us today received a receipt from Larry Rowley, the commissioner. He PDF'd us a receipt. It was proven that CSX, the owner of the property, paid the city of Brockton, reimbursed us back $35,107 is a zero balance, so they did pay us in full. I think that was the intent of the of continuing this to find out if we indeed did get paid. I know that I mentioned Mr. Rowley had told us that the last time we postponed this that he would get us the documentation. He got it today. I'm satisfied with that. Thus, I'm going to make a favorable recommendation back to the full council.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Recommend favorably full city council. All those in favor? Opposed?
Thank you.
Before we read number 22, we have 4 minutes left before the tape runs out. If we don't get this next one done in 4 minutes, we're going to have to take a recess for about 15 minutes and then finish. So, well, let's read 22.
Okay.
Very noble.
Resolve that the chairman of the Board of Assessors report to the City Council on the process and steps followed in assessing the value of homes in the city. Invited John O'Donnell, chairman of the Board of Assessors.
Council Beauregard.
Yes, hello. Thank you again, John O'Donnell, for being here this evening. We had had you come in front of us, and the last time that was to cover the information that was available. We're still hoping, we're in the plans of actually holding some kind of public information day and workshop beginning of January, right after people receive their tax bills so they can find out about the services available and what they can apply for. But I believe at this point you can let us know the latest on the assessment. I know I saw you carrying out huge books a couple of weeks ago, and what people can either go online to find out the value of their home now, or...
Okay. All values have been finalized by the DOR today. We got complete recertification. So yes, they can go online on the city's website, assessors, and all values are there, and they are certified.
Okay, so you said, I'm sorry, the DOR said...
DOR certified all values as of today.
Okay.
And they can go on the city's website. There still is information at the Council on Aging and at the library. They can come into our office and we have the information.
Okay, so find out about their homes. Okay, and this is all complete now, so that now the state will set the tax rate?
No, you people.
We set the tax rate.
Yes.
But we can't do it until the DOI has certified.
Okay, that's what I was trying. Okay.
So we'll be setting the tax rate shortly.
Shortly, okay. We don't have a date on that one?
Well, no, it'll be probably middle of December.
Middle of December, okay. All right, thank you. And that's where we are for now then, okay. Then thank you, Mr. O'Donnell. I open it up for anyone else.
Any other questions?
Motion favorable recommendation.
I second.
Motion recommend favorably to full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommend favorably.
Chairman, moment of personal privilege.
Quickly, could you read number 25 first?
Oh, sorry.
Resolved that the city auditor appear before a committee of the city council to review required auditing procedures, and that the city auditor is authorized and directed to implement policies and procedures to account for proper recording of data, processing of payments, and expenditure of funds. Further, that all departments, boards, and commissions are to adhere to the policies and procedures. Invited Mary Lynn Peters, to city auditor.
I would entertain a motion to postpone to the next...
Motion to postpone.
Second.
Motion to postpone to the next finance committee meeting. All those in favor?
Yeah.
Opposed? Postponed. Councilor Sullivan.
Mr. Chairman, of course, this Thursday is Thanksgiving. I want to wish each and every one of you a happy Thanksgiving, you and your families, but I also want to remind you that Brockton High football has a home game, 10 o'clock, so if you can go out there and see the boys and the girls, the cheerleaders, the band, the halftime dancers, the football players, the coaches, that'd be great. And then, of course, on Saturday... Mr. President, it's a big day, right? What are we doing here Saturday in the city of Brockton?
It is a big day. It's my favorite day of the year, even though I won't be here. I'm going to be out of town. But it's the Christmas parade. I do want to make sure all you councilors behave without me there. So, and also, one last item. Monday night, we have the meeting, co-meeting with the school committee to elect a replacement for Mr. McAllister to the Southeastern Regional Vocational Technical School Board. And a little clarification, we did send out notification today that will be in the Enterprise. It's on the city website. It's on the BCA. Any Brockton registered voter anywhere in the city can reach out to anybody, send in information to the city clerk's office, or reach out to any of us that is interested. But they must be a registered voter in the city of Brockton to qualify for that. And I know there's been a little bit of discussion that possibly this was done too quickly. And in fact, somebody complained that the school department did that. I am the only one to call this meeting. It's the ledger domain of the president of the city council. I wanted to give adequate time to Mr. McAllister's family to grieve, and I think 3 months was important. But the Southeastern Regional School Board reorganizes next week for their next term. So I thought it was very important to get this done. So we'll be here 7:30 next Monday evening.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, also on the parade, They are looking for volunteers to help out, so anybody that's interested in helping out the volunteer for the parade can contact John Marion at Marion's Tuxedos.
And the parade starts at 1 o'clock downtown.
Parade starts at 1 o'clock. Anybody else? I think we made it.